webinar on choosing the right eye oil. I'm Gaurav Luthra, and with me we have a galaxy of speakers and panelists. And today we will be discussing about how we can make good decision making on choosing the right lens for a particular situation. So how we've lined up today is that we will be introducing our speakers first, and we've set up an audience quiz for everyone. For that, you have to log in through the J&J portal, because quizzing will not be possible through our Facebook live feed and from the YouTube live feed. So if you're on the Facebook live feed and the YouTube live feed, I'll be showing you a link. You can take a snap of that link from your screens and try to log in through that if you want to be part of the audience poll. If you're not bothered about the audience poll, you can stay on your Facebook live or YouTube live feeds as well. So a very good evening to all our speakers, all our panelists. I'll be sharing my screen now. And this is the third IRSI webinar, and we will be choosing the right IOL for our patients. And so today we have with us, please take a picture of this if you would like to participate in the audience poll. There are two links, you can use either of them. There's a shortened link on top, which is on the tinyurl.com/y96j9a44. Or you can log into the webinar365.in/IIRSI-JNJ-webclinics3/. So if you log into one of these, you'll be able to participate and poll. You'll have a window on the side through which you can choose your choices once the poll comes up. I'll be introducing all our participants today, and then we'll have two questions for you for the audience quiz. We will do the remaining questions on the audience quiz at the end of the seminar. If you remain logged in right till the end, we'll have a very interesting panel discussion, and we'll be sharing the results of the audience quiz as well on what lens you might want to choose. So today we have an esteemed panel. We have with us Dr. Naushir Shroff, past president of IRSI and medical director of Shroff Eye Center in New Delhi, not a stranger to any one of us. Professor Mahipal Sachdev, President of AIUS, and more so the Chairman Scientific Committee of the IRSI, and of course needs no introduction at all. I think we see him every day nowadays. And Professor J.S. Tityal, again needs no introduction, Chief of Cataract and Refractive Surgery at the RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences in AIIMS, New Delhi. And then we have Dr. D. Ramamurthy, past president of AIUS, again, one of our top experts. So these are four of our panelists who will be giving us all the tips on once we have all our presenters present their cases, who will also participate in our discussions. We have an esteemed faculty. We have with us Dr. Namrata Sharma, again, no stranger to us. She has been doing an amazing job as the secretary of AIUS, arranging all the webinars with Professor Mahipal. And she's from the RP Center, AIIMS. Dr. Susan Jacob from Chennai, one of our pioneers, innovators, international pioneers, and who has done amazingly well on the ISRS and the international front. Dr. Kumar Doctor from the Doctor Eye Institute in Mumbai, who's again one of our prolific surgeons in cataract and refractive surgery, and most of the international meetings, he's always there. Then we have with us Dr. Himanshu Mehta, Vice President of the IRSI from the Vision Eye Center in Mumbai, again, a top surgeon, and if I might add, the surgeon to Amitabh Bachchan and his family and lots of other actors. And then we have with us Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary from Noida, head of the Eye Care Hospital. He's an NABH assessor, and he's into teaching PGs for DNB students. He's doing amazing work in cataract and refractive surgery. Then we have a young gun, Dr. Samresh Srivastava from the Raghudeep Eye Hospital in Jaipur. He's again a very, very polished young man with always impeccably dressed and very good with aberrometry, topography, and you say it. We have again with us Dr. Girish Jetwa from the Jetwa Eye Center in Anand. He's again a very, very skilled cataract and refractive surgeon and has some amazing cases to share with you today. And then last but not the least, Dr. Suresh Pandey from Kota Suvi Eye Hospital. He's been at the Apple Lab. He has done amazing work with IOS. He's doing a lot of cataract and refractive surgery. So we have very, very good two questions. So if you have all logged into the audience, this will give you an idea of how the poll is going to come to you later on. And Namrata Sharma, to prepare her first presentation, she'll be going in first. So I'm the moderator. I'll go on to the next. So we have
voice is breaking.
poll here. You can see on the right, you have this scary looking man. This is one of your patients. Control diamonds. One of the, can you hear me now? Okay. So we have this 65-year-old male lawyer. He has a cataract, more in the right eye, less in the left eye, with non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy and no maculopathy as such. He wears glasses. He has 1.75 astigmatism at 90 degrees. And in both eyes, this is a corneal astigmatism. And he's, of course, expecting a great outcome for both reading and distance. He loves to read. He loves to also go for his golf in the morning. So we have a few choices. You can see the vote on your panels. We can vote for A, multifocal IOL. We can vote for B, a multifocal toric IOL. Remember that he has corneal astigmatism of about 1.75 diopters. And he has... we can go for our third choice, which is extended depth of focus monofocal IOL. So basically, this is one of the newer generation monofocal IOLs with the extended depth. And there is also the option of using a good toric IOL without going for any of these. So remember that he has some background diabetic retinopathy and no maculopathy. He has astigmatism. He's 65 years old and he's a lawyer. Remember that. So he's wanting a great outcome and he can come back at you if he doesn't get a great result. So this is question number one. Please vote for that. And now we'll go on to question number two quickly. We have this Hollywood actress, 55 years old. She's a mild hyperope and she has bilateral significant cataract now. She's non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, and her anterior segment and fundus is unremarkable. She does some reading. And she does internet browsing and on the phone and the iPad. She does minimal driving herself. And she's keen for getting rid of her glasses. And she's never liked to use her reading glasses. And she's always used her contact lenses. Now, what would you choose for her? Would you go for one of the multifocal IOLs, the bifocal ones, which we have been using for a long time? Or would you like to go for a trifocal IOL? Would you like to go for an extended depth of focus monofocal lens? Or would you give her monovision? So you have four choices. You can vote either for a bifocal multifocal lens, a trifocal multifocal lens, extended depth of focus, monofocal, again, the new generation lenses, which can give you a little bit of range for intermediate and without multifocality. And then you could also offer her monovision. So these are the two questions for the audience. And now without wasting any time, you can please go ahead with your polls. If you're having any difficulty in doing the poll, please send in your comments because this we are experimenting with the polling for the first time. If you had any difficulty, please do share with us. I'm exiting from here. I'll request Dr. Namrata to please start her presentation. She'll be showing us two very interesting cases and then we'll put them up one after the other to the panel. Dr. Namrata.
So thank you, Gaurav, and thank you, RSI, for this opportunity. And I'll be talking to you about two cases. There are no financial or proprietary interests in any of the products that I am going to mention here. The case number one is a 60-year-old male who's a high myope, minus 8 diopters, come with phaco and IOL, which was operated 2 weeks ago, has a refraction of minus 3.75 sphere in this eye, and there is a capsular phimosis also which is present. And the fellow eye is pseudophakic, and the patient is emmetropic with a visual acuity of 6 by 6. So obviously in this, when anterior segment OCT was done, you can very clearly see that there is a capsular back distension syndrome, and you can see that there is fluid which is accumulated at the back. It is slightly opalescent or milky, the part which is at the posterior capsule. And this high definition anterior segment OCT helps you to know what is actually happening and what is actually the distance between the intraocular lens and the posterior capsule. So because we have the luxury of intraop OCT microscope, we decided to do a intraop OCT guided drainage of the fluid which was present at the back, and this is the case which was done. So you're just measuring the capsular excess size, which is about 4 millimeters, and this is followed by 2 paracenteses which were made, and subsequently viscoelastic is being injected, and following the injection of the viscoelastic with the help of the intravitreal scissors or any micro scissors, a nick is given in the anterior capsular rim. And just notice the intraop OCT microscope, which is showing you the pictures. There is a gap which is present between the lens and between the posterior capsule. And with the help of the intravitreal forceps, this is then removed. And you notice again the gap. As you're going on removing, this gap is going on decreasing in the area where it is being removed. So you can see that the distance between the lens and the posterior capsule is variable. At some places, it is decreasing because that stricture sort of a thing is already removed. So at some places, it is decreasing. And you again notice that the capsule will become crinkly now because the stricture which was there has been removed. So the taut capsule has actually become crinkly. And then you can go behind the intraocular lens and do a aspiration of the fluid which is present at the back. And as you do so, notice how the posterior capsule actually moves up towards the lens because the fluid which was present behind the lens has now been aspirated. So not that you need to do it, but it just helps you to understand what you are doing and it gives you a real life scenario, kind of a real time scenario, kind of a picture, actually what is happening. So in the end, you can see that the lens is completely stuck to the capsule and there is no gap which is present. And just notice how this moves up towards the capsule so that there is no fluid present in the retro pseudophakic space. So this was case one, and this is in the post-op period. Just notice that there's hardly any gap. And again, if you see the post-op anterior segment OCT, there's no gap present at all. And again, if you compare the pre and the post-op, notice that the gap is considerably decreased. And this is the pre-op and the post-op picture. Again, notice how this gap is completely decreased. So basically, classically, what has been described for a capsular back distension syndrome is that you could do even a YAC capsulotomy. But in this case, we didn't want to do a YAC capsulotomy because the patient was already a high myope. And because we have this intraop OCT microscope, and otherwise also we thought we would, take a call on doing the aspiration of the fluid which is present behind the intraocular lens. So, Gaurav, would you want to discuss this?
Yeah, so that was a really nice case, Dr. Namrata, and it highlights the importance. Obviously, all of us will not have access to the OCT, but what it basically brings home is that this is entirely possible, and we need to be careful about doing this. So at RPC, they could see it and document it so well for us. But it's very, very important when closing out the surgery that please watch out. You have to burp out, wash out the viscoelastic if you have used it very well, and then gently. Pressing on it. Anybody amongst our panelists, Dr. Nausher, would you have a quick comment on this, and then we can go on to the second.
Can I make a comment in this?
Yes, Dr. Tithyal, sir.
Because this.
What was the post-operative result of this? How much did the myopia decrease?
So the myopia did decrease. Post-op was about minus 0.5 myopia, and this is now 6 months, because this can accumulate again and again. And there have been cases where people have shown that it accumulates again. So, and most people have in fact done YAC capsulotomy for this. In this case, we deferred a YAC capsulotomy mainly because the patient was a high myope.
So actually, Namrata, I would have just done something, and just a small additional thing that I would do a small needle capsulotomy in the posterior capsule so that it does not recur. I don't know, Dr. Tiyal is smiling whether he agrees or he doesn't.
No, I agree to
he
this.
Agrees, I think.
Dr. Ramamurthy.
The technique is beautifully published in IGO by us.
Yeah.
And late capsular distension syndrome, where we have done an aspiration and done a PCC in these cases for a long term, clarity of visual axis.
Yeah,
because in a myopic patient, again, you will have opacity happening. And if you do a guarded PCC in these cases, the requirement of YAG will never occur in the future.
Yeah. And the second thing is, I think minus 3.5 is a little too much for the capsular distension.
The amount of distension that was there.
Dr. Ramamurthy wanted to say a quick thing.
The other suggestion is that, you don't really need to do a YAG posterior capsulotomy, but just YAG lasering of the capsular rim itself is good enough. Most often that is sufficient for the fluid to come out and the lens settles down. So as a primary procedure, of course, you have access to all the best of equipment. But in a clinical practice, I think instead of disrupting the posterior capsule, just opening up the rim of the capsule is good enough to relieve most of these cases.
Thank you, sir. I think that kind of... yes, Dr. Mahipal, a quick one. Otherwise, we'll ask Dr. Namrata.
Because they are bothered about it being a high myope and...
I'm not talking about posterior
capsular puncture, sir, with the YAC. Yes.
People have even done anterior capsulotomy and left it because that stricture sort of a thing is released and so the fluid escapes out. In some of the case reports, what Dr. Ramamurthy is saying, that also has been done.
Wonderful. Namrata, can you go on for the second case? Because we'll try to go run through. We want all our cases to be accommodated. Can you please go with the second one?
So the second case was a 75-year-old male with a white cataract and a trifocal intraocular lens has been planned in it. And the fellow eye showed features of not exactly posterior polar cataract, but there was onion-like appearance in the fellow eye. So this is the case, and this was a trifocal which is being put, completely white cataract. And this was actually loaded onto the, this was actually loaded inside, and there was some problem with the injector, so that only half the lens has gone in, the other half is not gone out, again, gone in. So what is done is that this lens is explanted. And now the problem is that at this point in time, there was no backup trifocal lens. And the patient had been previously consented that in the event of a problem, we may put a monofocal lens. So a monofocal lens in this case, after explanting this lens was put in place. But this case has basically been put to discuss the options which are available. Because if you are in a tricky situation such as this, where you plan a trifocal and some eventuality happens with a trifocal, then one, the options that are available are, and the panelists can dwell upon it, is that you should have a backup trifocal lens, or you should just leave the patient like this and put a second stage, maybe another day trifocal lens, or consent for a monofocal lens in the event of a problem before, you know, planning premium IOLs. And of course, if there is a problem like PCR and zonular dialysis, and I think I'm told that there are cases which will be shown like this, then because three-piece trifocal lens is not available by any of the platforms. So what would be your take on that?
I think that's a very interesting case, Namrata, and it's a real life situation because it can happen to any of us. How many people on the panel keep a backup multifocal lens of the same power as what they're implanting? Anybody? Dr. Ramamurthy and Dr. Samresh are raising hands. Himanshu is raising his hand. So most of us probably don't. But I think it's a great habit to do that. And so in case this happens, let's see. Let's ask Dr. Naushir how he would handle this situation.
No, I always have a trifocal lens. In case I didn't have a trifocal lens, I would put in a monofocal lens if the zonular system and the posterior capsule were intact. And if having taken the consent, or if it was a person who is very, very this thing, insisted on it, I would go another day and implant it in a multifocal lens.
I have another question quickly for all the panelists. You can raise your hands if you do it. Do we all talk and mention to our patients at the time of when we counsel them or when we meet them in the office that there is that rare possibility that we may not be able to use a trifocal lens as we have planned, or maybe that if we have planned a emetropia and we have a damaged lens and we can't put the correct part? So do we do all of us mention this to our patient, or is it mentioned in the consent? Of course, I think consents always carry it. But I think it's a great habit to mention that to the patient while talking to them that, yes, we are going to use a trifocal. You'll be able to read a bit. You'll be able to see. And, you know, just in case, in the best interest, we are not able to use it, we will use. Dr. Mahipal, you wanted to say something, sir?
So basically, an answer to your question, I would not discuss specifically that there could be a problem, et cetera, because that's part of the consent form that you can say that we can put another lens and then you can talk to the patient at that particular time. But I would rather, in the case of having an absence of a trifocal standby, I would postpone the surgery because lenses in Delhi are reasonably easily available and I can get them within an hour or something like that. Keep the patient, just wait outside and let him come back again and do it, even if it takes a day. And Namrata, I just want to just correct you from the perspective of a trifocal. Yes, I agree, there are no three-piece, but you still have three-piece by J&J. Just before the COVID thing, there is one of my patients who's waiting. So I had a PCR and that patient has a bifocal lens in the other eye. So I have postponed it and that patient is waiting for a glued IOL, a three-piece Technis, three multifocal they call, but that's a bifocal lens. So you still have the availability of these lenses, which are three-piece lenses, which you can do as glued IOL.
So I agree with Dr. Mahipal sir that we could use that on a later setting. Of course, at the time of the thing, if you have to manage it, you have to just manage with whatever you have. So I think keeping a standby for some of your VIP, especially if you're doing the second eye of a patient who has a multifocal in the first eye, you know, there it's even more critical. So having a standby lens would be a great idea. And we should ask our companies to support. Like, I think, thanks, Dr. Namrata, for those amazing questions.
Just a comment, Gaurav.
Yes, sir.
That, you know, trifocal, bifocal, multifocal and all is something we understand, our patients understand it to one some extent only. It's an intact capsule, it's just that the lens got split. I'm sure if there's a bifocal that is available, single piece multifocal is available, diaphragmatic multifocal, I'd have gone ahead and placed that instead of a monofocal, because it's more difficult to convince the patient from a trifocal to a monofocal, from a trifocal to a bifocal. I'm sure a large institute like yours, if it has a bifocal standby, I would have gone ahead and implanted that.
Very good idea, Dr. Ramamurthy, sir.
Ramu, it's not practical to have bifocal and trifocal inventories.
Like, for Shopify Center, sir, I'm sure it is possible.
Both bifocal now. Trifocals, one has an inventory maybe of trifocals. You can't have inventories of both bifocals and trifocals.
I think, you know, all the stalwarts sitting here can all afford to have inventories of as many lenses as they want. For our common ophthalmic surgeons like me, we probably can't afford that big. But let's go ahead.
I think I would probably go with what Dr. Mahipal said. That wait and implant, get a trifocal.
Put it on the negative.
That, because I'm not sure if after all my counseling of the patient that, you know, you're going to have less glare and halos as opposed to the previous generation where you had these bifocals and all that. And then finally I put this bifocal into his eye and he comes back at me with all the glare and the halos and everything. And a very unhappy patient, you know. So I think I would wait and implant at a second setting. Same day or the next.
I agree with you. And I think, you know, we have to take the best judgment at that time. We have all the options to us. Quickly, let's go on to our next presenter, Dr. Kumar Doctor from Bombay. He's going to show us a couple of really interesting cases.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
So I'll request Dr. Himanshu to keep his slides ready for the next, to uplink next.
So this is only one part that I'm going to show, and I'm not going to tell anything about formulas and et cetera, et cetera. I don't want to discuss that. I want to discuss a very small part as to when post-LASIK patients come to us, what are we really going to look at to decide what lens should be given to that patient. I would like to thank Suvira and Sri Ganesh. I'll tell you later on why, but let's imagine a 62-year-old male had LASIK 14 years back with a flying spot laser. We don't have the pre-op data. He said he was myopic about -5 to -7, and now is accepting about a myopia of -4, which we believe is lens induced in the 6-9 part. The rest of everything was normal, means tear film was normal, the retina was normal, OCT macula was normal, the optic nerve was normal, everything else was normal, the cell counter of the specula was normal. So all that was fine. So what do we have to look at in technology? So a lot of us have the Pentacam, the Cirrus, the Galilee, or the iTrace. How are we going to use this actually to best of our knowledge? And what are we going to use this is what we have to understand. Now, the patient wishes to have spectacle independence. This is what they want because that's what they've been used to in the young life. But what is the choice of the IOL that you will want and why is what I want to discuss. And in this case, I want to discuss only myopic LASIK. I don't want to confuse the rest of it. And what special analysis would you do different in such patients as far as the cornea is concerned as to consider which IOL? So now I want to go to the expert panel because this was more of a discussion. I will show some images, whatever you need, and what are your criteria to look at is what now I would like to take the panel to take over and tell me what is their thought process. Dr. Namrata, please, first, or whoever is answering.
Yes. Okay, Namrata, you can go first. Yes. If Namrata is not there, we can ask Dr. Ramamurthy to comment on this.
Basically, you know, he already said it. Beyond -5-6 diopters, I would be wary of using a multifocals or something. Up to -5 diopters, it is okay. Secondly, I will ask the patient, how was the quality of vision he enjoyed soon after the LASIK treatment? If he says that he had an excellent vision, that means it was a well-done treatment and the results with cataract surgery is also going to be looking at the topography. If I see a sea of green and there's no abnormal aberrations, that again is something which should tell me that even something like a EDOF lens would be all right in a situation like this. And fourthly, I would look at the amount of corneal aberrations. If it is a higher order aberration, the root mean square is beyond 0.3 or a 0.4 microns, I'll be wary of putting in a multifocal in this patient. Otherwise, I'll go ahead and place this lens. And of course, Kumar did mention that he's not going into the formula. But the formula I would use is a Barrett 2K formula, yeah, which in our experience we have found gives the best results as far as these post-classic eyes are concerned.
Yes. So,
Dr. Tithyan, would you like to add?
Dr. Tithyan, sir?
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Ram, what he said. As far as I'm concerned, I'm going to use a Barrett 2K for this patient also. And normally, selection of eye well, I would convince the person, if possible, for a monofocal lenses, because the contrast as such will be poorer post-LASIK cases, especially minus 7 treatment. If that patient is not really, going with the idea of monofocal, then trifocal may be a best option at this stage.
So, what did you do?
Yes, I'll tell you what we're looking at here, and now we'll again check different scenarios. So here we have to look at whether this ablation is well centered and there's no ectasia. We look at the spherical ablation and the coma. We have to make sure if at all there's any astigmatism, whether it's regular. And we look at the EKR, and we have to have the high order aberration less than 0.4. Now, as rightly mentioned by Dr. Ramamurthy, that the myopic treatments have to be low. And it's obvious that you have to do an optical biometry and the lens calculation according to the Barrett 2K. So this is the image of the map of the patient. You can see it's 3940. It's a center treatment. If you look at the EKR in the 4.5 millimeter zone, it's spread about three, so from 38 to 41, so about 3 to 4 diopters. That is one information that we have to look at. Again, if you look at the high order aberration here, so you look at the ACD of 3.06, and if you look at the total corneal high order aberration is 0.172. As rightly mentioned, this is in a 4 millimeter zone. Okay, so we have to look at the 4 millimeter zone and the 6 millimeter zone. If it is less than 0.4, the patient should be okay with a multifocal. Now here again, we look at the high order aberration. Here you can see at 0.7172 and the spherical aberration of 0.152. So the total is 0.172. So this patient would do quite well with a multifocal IOL. So this is what we have to look at in the cornea, is what is the take-home message I want to give. So anyone wants to add to this list a well-centered corneal ablation, no ectasia, look at the spherical ablation, look at the coma, because if the patients have a large high coma, they're not going to be happy with a multifocal IOL. Okay, a regular astigmatism, look at the EKR and the high order. Does anyone want to add 2-3 points to this list? So we take a message home that yes, this is
Dr. Nausher, I think you were joined by Rushad. Is he there with you? He is quite an expert at these things. Yes.
Same thing. I was just going to mention about the EKR. I think sir covered it quite well. That's something that you definitely look at in these cases. And also look at the standard deviation EKR, also to make sure that the axis is not changing in the 1, 2, 3 and 4 millimeter areas in the EKR chart itself. Because across the pupil, it shouldn't be at different meridians, so to speak. That's probably the only thing that I would add.
Wonderful. Thanks, sir.
I would opt for a
lens
with the highest asphericity possible, because this is obviously a cornea with a lot of positive asphericity. So,
going into that, Rama.
Yeah.
Kumar, go ahead. Okay, Dr. Mahipal, quickly, yes.
One more thing that I'll tell the patient, that you should be prepared for a touch-up. Because yes, I think you should not ignore that if there is a residual error that is there. But as a rule, I normally don't prefer multifocal. I would rather tell the patient to go in for a monovision. Today, an eye hands with a monovision.
That was as far as the myopic goes. Can I
continue, Gaurav? Okay, go ahead, Kumar, please. Yeah.
Now we show you a different case of a hyperopic LASIK. We have a lot of theory to talk about, and practically I've done something else, and I'll tell you what I did. So what different will you look for in a patient who has had hyperopic LASIK? So now look at this EKR, 45 to 51, and this is in the 4.5 millimeter zone. If you look at the high order aberration of the cornea, is 0.492. And the ACD is 2.68. This patient had hyperopic LASIK years back. Okay. So you again look at the high order aberration, 0.492. Okay. And you can look at the coma here is 0.426. That's the center to a coma. The other two sides are trefoil. And below that is the high order aberration. Above that is the low order aberration. Okay. So hyperopic LASIK, what is your opinion, or all of you on the panel or anybody from the rest of the panel, as to will you select in such a case scenario to do a Edoflex or a multifocal or just a monofocal?
So let's go. Let's start with Samaresh. Are you there?
Yes, sir. Sir, yeah. So my experience with patients undergoing cataract surgery post hyperopic LASIK is less. I've personally not operated a post hyperopic LASIK patients, but these are the patients where, anyways, LASIK was also a query because we were not able to find out the right power. I would prefer to put a monofocal lens in these patients for many reasons, mostly because of residual refractive error and the decentration. So my choice for this patient would be to put a standard monofocal lens and not counsel them for a multifocal lens of any sort.
Okay, Dr. Himanshu, would you like to chip in here?
Oh, yeah, very, very interesting. All these patients who undergone LASIK surgery, we have to take it for granted, want to be spectacle-free, whatever we say. However much we warn them that you may not be a very happy candidate, we may not be able to get your correct measurements, all that, all said and done. But having said that, they want that. So as Kumar said, that putting a multifocal or anything in a hyperopic patient is a problem. But they rather have that little problem than not have. So they you make them a little myopic if they can see their cell phone. That's one thing which they really appreciate. This could be a myopic LASIK or a hypermetropic LASIK. And as he said, if you have a very high order astigmatism and you have high trefoil coma, then of course you're not going to pair in for a multifocal. But monovision is the least that they expect from us.
No, I think, I would rather stay away from multifocal in this case. Quite a lot of aberrations and it's a hyperprolate cornea. Actually, I'd go for a spherical monofocal lens in this case. Actually, what I would put in a sensor intraocular lens for the simple reason that it's something which will take care of the extreme negative spherical aberration on the cornea. And this would give you the best quality of vision. Of course, the price the patient has to pay is that maybe you can do monovision in the other eye. But better not to go for multifocal. Don't go for an aspheric lens. But in a hyperprolate eye which has been treated for hyperopia, I think something like a sensor lenses would be my choice.
Yeah, so I also agree with that. Basically, in post-myopic LASIK patients, they do better with negative spherical aberration IOLs, and post-hyperopic LASIK patients do better with the traditional, the olden time lenses which have positive spherical aberration. And I also would probably stay away from multifocals. And when you select the aspheric IOLs also, you have to remember that the Bausch & Lomb aspheric is zero spherical aberration. So that is not the one you would like. You would want one which has a negative spherical aberration actually for myopic, post-myopic LASIK patients.
So,
Kumar, would you like to wind up with this so that we can go on to the next one? What did you do for your patient?
So one more case, can I show it fast? So I won't go into eye trace because that helps you too, but I want to show one more case. So what different did I do? One is all these patients I've done are EDOF lens. Even hyperopic LASIK patients, I've done EDOF. So I have four patients which I have undergone hyperopic LASIK and I've done EDOF, and that's the Symphony IOL. The main reason being Symphony IOL itself does not reduce contrast. Yes, the patients do complain of two rings or glare and starburst phenomena. But at the end of it, like what Himanshu said, that these patients are very happy not wearing the spectacles. Now, is the quality of vision really compromised? The answer may be yes. Yes, I should not have done it because both are negative. The cornea is negative and the lens is negative and both are not helping each other. But I have done EDOF and both the patients are very happy. One last scenario that I want to discuss is Sri Ganesh's own slide. And what are we going to do when patients have undergone press beyond or press by max? So this is Sri Ganesh's own slide. He had a plus hyperopia before. And you can see his post-op is minus 1.75 in this. Now, these patients in the future are going to come to us for cataract surgery. So question here is, which IOL? Now, we all understand here that I think technically what Ramamurthy said would be perfect. That in such patients, I don't think there's any discussion. We just go ahead and put a sensor IOL in that eye, which is the press beyond eye. And that should help. And the press beyond portion itself would continue. So if anybody wants to discuss the press biopic LASIK part of it. So that was the hyperopic, the myopic, and now the press biopic part as to what IOL is advisable for such patients. Anyone in the panel can take over.
Yeah, so
you take a quick one because you have to go on. Dr. Mahipal, only you will speak for a quick one.
Yes. So Kumar, the issue is that whatever the press biopic correction has been done on the cornea would stay. Okay, so that the only thing is that you should target the minus in one eye to where it had been targeted earlier, and the other eye you should try to keep as emetropic, the dominant non-dominant eye, and yes. Not wish to add anything else as a multifocal or a trifocal lens within the eye, because the cornea is still working vis-a-vis the spherical abrasions that you have induced on both the eyes to get the depth of focus. That's my take on it.
So, I'll just tell you one thing, because this question was there yesterday and Sri Ganesh was a part of the webinar and so was Professor Tityal, and we asked him what lens he would want in his eye. So he said, I would want a monofocal lens.
Yeah, that's what he wants to set
this up. He said, because I've already got a presbyon done, and exactly the same reasoning he gave, which...
question to all the cornea people here is, according to my information, cornea modulates over time. So whatever presbyopic correction we've done at the cornea level doesn't last for years to come.
Yeah.
Although Sri Ganesh has got it done 5 years back, he's still okay. But what is your thought process on this, that it's not going to last forever?
No,
it's not going to be like a Kamra thing.
The point is that supposing it does not last, a lot of people go in for an enhancement within the presbyopic correction. So you have to see at that particular time as to where that presbyopic correction is on the cornea. So if the presbyopic correction is lasting at that particular time, you can do it, or you can do an enhancement subsequently also onto the presbyopic, because these are all flap-based LASIK procedures. So you could enhance on the cornea, top it up on the cornea, rather than putting something in the eye and then not, because you always have the top-up option with you.
Perfect. I think those were excellent points. I think we have lots more to come up. So Kumar, can you please disconnect your slides? And for the backend team, I've just received a few comments from our viewers that we are not streaming on YouTube properly. Please look into it. There is some problem with the YouTube streaming. We'll request Dr. Himanshu to now share a couple of his very interesting questions. And I'll request Susan to please keep her presentation ready for the next one. Dr. Himanshu, we want you to really go fast on this and have the best out of the panelists. Thanks.
Thanks for the time. It's an interesting scenario. This is an interesting scenario which I wanted to discuss, which is the right IOL for a person who's around 50, who has undergone a monofocal in one eye because he was told that multifocals will have a problem. Now he has a huge problem. He doesn't want to use glasses. He is there sitting here. He sees a lot of his friends who got his surgeries done, and they are very happy with their multifocal lenses. Now he's in a dilemma. So he has a right eye monofocal toric already put in one eye, left eye cataract at present. His best corrected visual acuity is 20/25 and unable to read his smartphone computer. He's a stockbroker and he's a fund manager. So he has to see multiple distances, his cell phone, his computer monitor, NSE terminal, and his staff. So patient has insisted on a monofocal, and now this is a very common problem which I have seen. Whenever you explain to a patient that with monofocal, they will not be able to have multifocality, they agree and say everything yes in the beginning. But so you say that, okay, you want distance vision, you give them distance vision. They are extremely unhappy within 48 hours that I can't see my cell phone. I have a very classical lady, same 55-year-old. She said, no, doc, I want monofocal. I did exact monofocal with 1.5. She could read her WhatsApp very happy second day, that for the first time in the last 15 years, I can read my WhatsApp. But within 3 weeks, she was unhappy, doc, I could see distance. I can't see my distance. Now, this is the dilemma that we all face. They can take you for a ride despite explaining everything. Having said that, if you have monofocal, is it right to put a multifocal in the second eye? The patient wants multifocality. They all want to see at all distances without glasses. It is taken for granted by us, by giving them, that after any cataract surgery, whichever lens they choose, whatever mistakes they make, whatever intellectual decisions we make, they don't want to wear glasses. So what are my options? He can't see his cell phone. So monofocal with monovision, evolved monofocal, evolve the new one which is coming up, a trifocal, EDOF, or a Minivel which is ring-free with multifocality. I would like suggestions from the panel.
So Dr. Tityal, sir, what would you suggest, sir?
It depends on what type of patient you are dealing with. What Himanshu is saying, patient has psychologically, bound to have a multifocal vision. I think that scenario, if the other eye doesn't have significant aberrations and astigmatism is manageable, I might take him for a trifocal, the new generation trifocal lens for him, and see how he does. Because same scenario can be there in other way around also. But if patient is not happy with monofocal lens, mm-hmm. I'll go for trifocal and see how he adapts to a subsequent post-op period. If the capsular bag is intact and good, subsequently, if he's happy with the trifocal, I might change the other lens to trifocal in the right eye also.
So there is no taboo in doing a multifocal in one eye and a monofocal in the other eye.
That I understand.
That's right. Are you with me on that? That it's fine.
Yes.
Would anybody contradict this from our panelists?
That's right.
Yeah. Gaurav?
Yes, sir.
The EDOF lenses, when you talk about, are the EDOF lenses
Symphony.
Include Eyhance as an EDOF lens?
So, sir, no. Extended
you're
range of
about vision. Symphony also or Eyhance also?
So, I think
because
the
Eyhance also.
So, the extended range of vision is the Symphony.
Some amount of depth of focus and thereby. So, and I would put a Eyhance lens because that doesn't have any of the problems that are there with a multifocal lens or a trifocal lens.
I would go with what Dr. Tityal suggested because this patient essentially wants good near vision. And EDOF or Eyhance, though good lenses, we use them widely, is not going to give you that. So we often come across this situation where one eye has been done years back and now this patient comes to the second eye looking for multifocality. I think though it's recommended that it should be bilaterally the same lens, many of us are putting this one eye monofocal, one eye multifocal with reasonably good results. I would opt for a trifocal, which gives good vision. EDOF for Eyhance will compromise near vision and again may not end up with a very happy patient.
So I have a quick question that when you use a multifocal in the second eye, how many of these patients, you know, want some kind of multifocality in the other eye, the first eye as well, and you go in and do a piggyback or something?
Yeah. Majority of these, sorry, I mean, you're asking me or someone?
Yes.
Normally, okay. They adapt very well. Well, once they have a monofocal lens in one eye, which gives a sharper distance vision. And this monofocal lens also adapts the other eye into, visual symptoms also. I've seen patient having a multifocal in one eye, another eye going for monofocal, and their symptoms go down significantly.
I'm Susan Jacob, and in this video, I'm going to show you my technique.
Oh, sorry, Susan, as a...
I'm so sorry. That's okay.
So I think the take-home message is quite clear. Dr. Himanshu, can we go on to the next one unless you want to add
I'll
something?
I'll just quickly say that I agree with Dr. Tityal. I just did a trifocal lens, but EDOF, one thing which universally everybody agrees that even if it's monofocal one eye and a trifocal in the other eye, the patient adapts very beautifully in the neurologically. That's not a big problem. And EDOF is a very forgiving lens. That's another thing. If you have a little time, I'll go through quickly with another case. Quickly.
Please do. Let's quickly go through it. And we can see the young ophthalmologist from Vision Eye Clinic joining you, Dr. Himanshu.
Very comfortably. Before the surgery, but now your stress tension is less.
So what I was trying to show here was this patient was very happy. He was a stockbroker and he said, one eye monofocal, multifocal, perfectly fine. Here is a young patient, you know, a 30-year-old guy who is a music mixer and he has got a cataract. He's a high myope, can't see properly. What is it that we will do for a patient of this caliber? A 30-year-old sound mixer recording guy, he works in low illumination in the evenings and high myope, dense cataract in the right eye. Visual requirement, of course, everybody wants everything at any given point of time. Near vision on the computer, cell phone in low light, and regular vision in a crowd while performing, and of course for driving. A patient needs mobile, computer, and infinity vision. What lens would you put?
So who wants to go with this? Dr. Mahipal, sir, let's hear you.
Can I go, Ro?
Yes.
Who speak?
Dr. Mahipal, sir, would you like to comment on this? Kumar, would you like to comment on this?
So I would prefer to put a Symphony. The main reason is that, you know, it may not give a very good near, but it will give him excellent intermediate. It does not affect his, it will not cause loss of contrast because Symphony does not reduce contrast. It's the same as the Technis 1 IOL or one of the mini ones, which has a small ring and multifocality, which also gives near. So either one of these two, I would select. So of course, there's no toricity available in the mini one yet, but the Symphony has the toric available.
We have also Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary there. He is sitting quietly. Can we have Saurabh comment and then we'll have Dr. Jetwa comment on this quickly?
Yeah, I'll definitely go ahead with the ADOF lens here. And if it is a toric, I'll go ahead with the Symphony toric. Otherwise, the mini-well lens does pretty well as well. I've put a few. So if it's the matter of contrast, I might shift more towards the mini-well lens.
Dr. Jetwa, would you like to differ, sir?
Yes, I think I will agree with the same thing. The only thing is, in a recently, I will prefer to go for an Eyhance monofocal, which gives a little bit more depth of focus. And as a young patient, he will not accept any glare, halos, and starburst. So my choice is IHANS. Both eyes, one by one, and little bit mismatch or micromorphism.
So I think there's fair consensus. Is there anybody on the panel who would like to differ and give a different view to this?
I would just, in case we are going in for a symphony, I would strongly recommend bilateral implantation and go for a mini mono vision in the second eye, because he wants good quality of vision near, intermediate, and distance. Symphony, though an excellent lens, is not quite adequate for near in one eye alone. So it's extremely important that we recommend that both eyes need to be done, and aim at the second eye for about minus 0.75 or so.
So actually, that's what ultimately this patient is going to develop a cataract pretty soon in the other eye, which he did. And in the, within less than 6 months, we had done the other eye symphony with micromonovision.
Wonderful.
Now, what is on the table, I suppose, what is likely to come is something called a Symphony Plus, which is likely to give you more near vision. And I think the new lens that is a combination of EDOF plus trifocal, I think that will be lens of the future.
Synergy.
Yeah.
Synergy lens should be out soon, yes.
Yeah, so I think that will be more of the future. So this EDOF, because they also, the company realizes that the EDOF is not giving enough reading at. So they have come out with the same kind of transmission and the same kind of contrast with what they are going to put as Symphony Plus. I think it has already got FDA approval in the US or something, but that's the next thing which gives you a little better near at than what the present Symphony is doing.
So I think we've had good discussion, and we'll quickly go on, sir. Dr. Himanshu, if you can de-link your presentation, I'll request Dr. Susan to share her two very interesting cases. And I'll request Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary to please keep his presentation ready for the next uplinking, please.
So thanks a lot, Gaurav, for inviting me here. My cases are very simple. I'm not going to show any videos. It's just two situations that I'm going to talk about. And I'd like the panel to, you know, kind of say what they would like to do in these situations. So the first patient was a patient who was a 36-year-old type A personality. He wanted everything to go exactly the way he wants and wants perfection. He had posterior polar cataracts in both the eyes. And he's got a minus 1.5 diopter cylinder astigmatism. So what I planned was phaco-vitoric IOL. And the surgery went smoothly until cortical removal, at which point there was a posterior capsular rent. So at this point, I did a vitrectomy properly. Posterior capsular support was insufficient to put it in the bag. I couldn't have converted the tear into a small PCCC or anything. So, you know, I'd like to ask the panel, what should I do at this point? And what should be my thought process at this point of time?
That's a wonderful question. I'll request Dr. Suresh Pandey to please come in here and comment how he would have handled this.
Actually, this is a very interesting scenario. I would like to do vitrectomy as Dr. Sujan already did it. The posterior capsule support was insufficient. So at this stage, I would consider the glued IOL to fixate the lens using the glued IOL technique.
So there is proper anterior capsular support. I'll just come to that. The anterior capsule is still intact.
The rim is intact. Yes.
Yeah, anterior capsule is intact. Then we can perhaps implant the lens in the sulcus. And if you have inventory, perhaps you can consider putting the sulcoflex toric lens in the sulcus. This is also a possibility. But most of us, we don't have the inventory of the supplementary lens such as sulcoflex lens. And you can go ahead with the three-piece lens such as technisosensor lens do the optic capture, anterior capsule optic capture. That can help to stabilize the lens in such scenario.
Yeah.
So that's nice. And sir, Dr. Tityal, sir, would you like to add to this?
Very interesting comment from Suresh. I think I accept the fact if there's no support from the posterior capsule wise, I might go for a monofocal lens for that patient, sulcus with optic capture in this case, and subsequently try to see the post-op assessment of patient. If patient not happy with the glasses, then think of a sulcoflex lens subsequently. But sometimes we do have scenario, if our axis is good, we can do a reverse optic capture, putting the haptic orientation to the axis which is desired and do a reverse capture, and that can suffice. So I have a few series of patients where I've done a reverse capture and a patient do well in that scenario also.
Also,
we can do a surface treatment later on for the cylinder if necessary.
Right.
So, So ideally, a toric lens should not be dented in case of a PCR. Even if you want to do a reverse optic capture, you can do that. But toric IOLs are normally single piece lenses and they should not be placed in the sulcus. So ideally, you should switch over to a three-piece lens. And as Kumar said, that you can, if the patient is very unhappy, you can touch it up on the cornea. That's something if the lens is unstable and it rotates, then it can do increase the astigmatism. If it goes more than 20-30 degrees, then it can increase the astigmatism. So I would rather not play with a toric lens in the sulcus. A capture.
So, Ramamurthy wants to share something. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, Susan, you did not mention whether it's with the rule or against the rule astigmatism. The patient is just 36 years old. Is a quite a possibility that he has with the rule astigmatism, in which case, once you're done, even with a monofocal lens with a good optic capture, he might end up with just about a 0.75 diopter of cylinder or something, because the posterior cornea is going to compensate for part of his cylinder. And if that happens, I think why talk about a secondary lens and all that? I think the cornea is there, it's likely to be healthy. So just go ahead and do a touch up with the laser in case there is a residual astigmatism.
Wonderful. I think we have consensus on most of the people are saying the same thing. I would have also thought of doing a small, you know, primary posterior capsular rexus. If you can convert it into a small rexus, you could still go ahead and put it in the, if the vitreous doesn't present. It's not very often that that will happen. So, Susan, how did you manage it?
Would you consider, would anyone consider doing an LRI as well at this point?
Yes.
Because, you know, single piece IOL, the three piece IOL in the sulcus with capture and maybe an LRI.
Definitely.
The first thing, Susan, is that when you calculated the toricity, did you take the posterior corneal astigmatism into account, or it was just basis this thing? Because as Dr. Ramamurthy rightly said, you're expecting to get a decay in the with the rule to against the rule over time, and the patient may not really. So you have to kind of be less aggressive when you are doing with the rule in a young person rather than doing an against the rule. So that also will play an important role. As to whether you should be, but yes, what you are saying is slipped my mind, but you could do an LRI, but I would prefer not to do an LRI with a diamond knife or something. I would prefer to do it with a femto.
Would you go back and read off after all this vitreous loss and everything?
Then I will wait for the patient to be there for 3 months and then see what the residual astigmatism and how unhappy the patient is. I'll not redoc at that particular moment. But one thing which our paper has just been published in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery in February is that when you are doing the OCT at that particular time, in almost all the cases, we are able to find out whether there's a pre-existing rent or not in this particular case, because you see a defect in the posterior capsule. So if I see a pre-existing defect in the capsule, I'll tell the patient at that particular time that you are not going to be suitable for a toric lens, because almost 100% of the time, it has got a very high specificity and sensitivity. So we will, at that particular time, only plan an LRI.
So I think we quickly go on to the next one, because we've had a good discussion on this. Susan, can you quickly go on to your next one? We are running really behind schedule now.
So this is case number two, who was actually a nice gentleman, unlike all the usual patients we get. You know, he's a 60-year-old, quite a reasonable gentleman. He's got a two-quadrant subluxation of the IOL. He does want the fashionable robotic surgery because he's been hearing about it so much in newspapers and advertisements and everything. He would like to have a premium IOL. And now, this is not a case I've operated so far, so this is something I'd like to get your opinion about. He wants he would like to, if possible, have a premium IOL and freedom from glasses, which of course all patients and we want. His other eye is 6-6 and with plus 2.5. I mean, that's wrong. His other eye is 6-12 and he with improvement, he is coming to SNIN 6 though. And he's willing for cataract surgery in the other eye, provided he gets a good result in the first eye.
That's
so what
nice.
Would you... What would you do for this patient?
So let's see. Dr. Nausheer, sir, would you like to comment on this one?
I think that you can go on with this kind of this thing. We can go on with a femto cataract surgery and implant. And if we can make it with the ECR endocapsular ring and a monofocal lens, that's what I will do. A premium IOL means that aspherical lens is also a premium IOL. So she's not mentioned any cylinder or anything like that in the. So we
I think Susan is suggesting that the patient wants to read without glasses, sir. I think. Is that right, Susan?
Yeah, he basically wants freedom from.
Before you go on, what is the cause of the subluxation? That is something very important. What is the cause of the subluxation.
What is the extent of subluxation?
Is a history of injury about a year back. He's got a 2-quadrant subluxation.
Okay, so if it is, you know, think your management would be different if there is a specific history of trauma and there is no vitreous presentation, then you can expect that the subluxation would not increase over time. So that would be an important consideration for you to choose a lens.
Right.
So anybody would do anything differently? I mean, would you not use a multifocal lens? Would you kind of support the bag in some way?
No. Yes.
I would.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I would counsel the patient that a multifocal may not be possible, but this is a situation where a laser cataract surgery, even if the patient doesn't want, might be of great usage because you could get an excellent rexus. And then with the help of capsular hook, support the bag and then go ahead and fix the bag either with Ahmed segment or with a Sioni ring, and then try to implant a multifocal lens in the bag, supposing the surgery goes off very well. In case I lose the bag and things are not under control, then I would rather go ahead and implant a monofocal lens and tell the patient that that's the best I could do for him.
So I think Dr. Himanshu wants to say a quick one, and then we'll allow Susan to finish this case.
Quickly. Although I just want to say every time where Susan mentioned is, the patient wants this, the patient wants that. For once, tell him we are going to save his eye first. He's got a subluxated. Put the onus on him. The onus is consistently on us. After that, as Ramu said, very clear.
That's a very good thought. Sometimes we go by what the patient says and
No. He wants anything. He wants the sky. I also want the sky. But first,
sometimes we should impose on them for the sake of safety. Susan, how did you manage it? And I have an inkling on what you might have done with the iris hook, I think. Let's see. Okay.
So this is a case that I've not done as yet, but what I'm planning to do in this patient is, of course, with all the appropriate counseling Dr. Himanshu said, I'll be telling him, you know, that these are the options, this is what can happen, but if things go wrong, this is not what is going to be happening in your eye. So I'm planning to put a glued capsular hook, which I'm sure, Gaurav, that's what you guessed.
That's exactly what I meant, yes.
which is the sutureless technique, where basically I can get rid of, instead of doing an IMS segment or a Sioni ring where I have to pass sutures and all these things, I'm planning to just put a glued capsular hook or a paperclip capsule stabilizer where I can just pull the capsula back and fix it. And once I do that, if I find that I've got good centration, I was thinking of either putting in an EDOF IUL or an IHANS, both of which would give him some amount of, you know, freedom from glasses for distance and intermediate to a large extent. And then go, and if he's happy with the first try, which he should be, hopefully, and of course a robotic, as Dr. Amurthy or one of the other panelists also said, it will give you a good rexus. For the other eye, I would do a micro monovision so that he would get a good reading vision as well. And I think that would kind of give him a reasonable good, freedom from glasses for all distances. So that's basically my plan.
If it doesn't work,
I would do a glued IOL.
So Susan has a fantastic channel on which you can see these videos. I'm sure this video is there. But for an ordinary surgeon, Dr. Tityal, can you give a take-home message that what would we do? And let's finish and move on to the next one.
I think the point of, you know, the cause for a subluxation is very important. If it's a post-traumatic, maybe the back fixation will suffice. And 2-quadrant subluxation is a large one. So some sort of a back fixation will be required in this patient. And most likely, a multifocal lens may not be very, very stable without back fixation. If back fixation is done well, then you can use any type of IOL in this patient.
Wonderful. Thank you, sir. And I think, Susan, thanks. Anything you want to finish off with?
Just the reason I prefer IHANS or EDOF is, even if I do get some amount of decentration, I'll still be okay. It will not be as bad as with a multifocal IOL. So that was my thought process on this.
Wonderful. Thanks a lot. Susan, can you de-link your presentation? I think we have Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary next. And I'll request Dr. Suresh to be ready with his presentation. And Dr. Suresh, you have very interesting cases, but I'll request you to kind of lead us fast through these because we have lots more to come. Thank you so much. Dr. Suresh is a very innovative surgeon out of Kota, does lots of premium IOLs and other stuff that we keep watching on his YouTube channel.
Saurabh, who's coming up now?
So I think Saurabh, Saurabh was supposed to come up and then Suresh will come up later. Saurabh, you have to link
no,
up.
No, Dr. Saurabh, you can go ahead. Dr. Saurabh, please.
Saurabh, can you uplink your... I'm so sorry for creating the confusion there.
No. That's okay. Right, my slides are up there. Can
yes, Saurabh. Thank you so much. Again, all your surgeries.
So that's two corona lens, right?
Yeah. So that we're talking about a 62-year-old diabetic male controlled on medication. Again, a lawyer in a private law firm, plays golf a bit, self-drives at night. In the morning, in the daytime, he has a driver on duty. He's never used glasses, but it's his first visit to the ophthalmologist with complaint of poor quality of vision for the past 6 months. The BCVA in the right eye was 6x12 N8, and the left eye was 6x9 N6. The IOP was within the normal limits. The slit lamp examination showed a clear cornea, a shallow AC with gonioscopically open angles. Exfoliation in the right eye, which was poorly dilating, about 4 millimeters, and the left eye was dilating normally. There's a grade 2 cataract in both the eyes with no phacodonosis in the right eye. The keratometry is 43.5 and 45 diopters in the right eye, and the retina was normal. And he does want spectacle-free vision, like his brother, who was operated elsewhere. Now, I'll just, this is a short video which I'll just try to interject here, and I don't think so we'll be able to see very well, but that's the end of the surgery. That's the that's a little bit of cortex which is left behind, and we're trying to just stretch it and see what's behind there. And we can actually see the back bulge up totally. So it's the PC which is bulging. And once the PC was bulging up, so we do see a lot of stria in the PC, but the cortex is there. And so I'll just take a pause here, and I'll put it across to the panelists. So just to sum it up, diabetic lawyer, drives at night, never used glasses earlier, has pseudo-exfoliation in this right eye, poorly dilating, PC bulge after a cataract removal, has a lot of astigmatism and does not want to wear glasses like his brother who underwent a surgery elsewhere.
Dr. Jetwasa, would you like to comment on this?
Yes, I would like to go for a patient has a pseudo exfoliation syndrome. I would like to go for a CTR with IHANS in this case, because patient is a diabetic and also a lawyer. So this will be my first preference.
But no, but IHANS doesn't have toric.
Toric, yeah.
My advanced talk is still not available.
Kumar, can you chip in with what you would like to do?
I would like to put a dispersive viscoelastic because there's a bulge in the PC to see what's happening to the IOP. If that's staying there, that means it will stay. And then I would, as agreed, as said by Dr. Jetwa, I would put an endocapsular ring because there's pseudo exfoliation. And then put a symphony toric, explaining to him about night glare when he drives.
Yeah, so... Gaurav, the endocapsular ring, just because the patient has pseudo exfoliation, should have been planned right from the beginning. And as Kumar said, if there is an upthrust or whatever, I would rather have a fast bolus of mannitol being given and see as to how the posterior capsule is behaving. So I really don't know why the upthrust was, but if the capsule is intact and you are able to push down the vitreous and you can put in the endocapsular ring, then you can go ahead with a toric lens. Variety, so that's not a problem. The cortex can be taken out subsequently.
I agree with that, sir. And anybody else would like to differ? Or
I would like to. Can I make a comment?
Yes.
I would like to use a dispersive viscoelastic, such as viscote, and then I may use some pupillary expansion device, such as Mallewegian ring or Buttigieg Schulze ring. To just ensure that I can see properly. And if there is too much vitreous pressure, then it may be good idea to do pars plana vitreous tape using the 26-gauge needle or some sutureless vitrectomy technique.
So I think, Saurabh, can you quickly show us what you actually did? Yeah, you were trying to show us the video of maybe what did you actually do there?
Okay, so I went ahead and put a dispersive viscoelastic. And, following that, we put an endocapsular ring. And as the patient, we had anticipated this because he was pseudo exfoliation, and we were thinking about a pupil expander, but we thought that we can still go ahead and do the cataract surgery. The patient is under topical. We're just adding some more visco each time because it's a bulge in the PC. So it's not that it's the vitreous which is pushing it up. It's a lax sort of a bag. So once we put the endocapsular ring, we feel that this ring, once it goes into the bag, everything is stable. So I'll just jump it, and we then went ahead and did a very slow sort of a bimanual cortical removal, and went ahead and put a lens which is a toric symphony. A toric symphony lens has been put in this case. So that's what the lens has been put in. You can see that after the endocapsular ring has been put, there was the bag was pretty stable, and then we went ahead and put a toric symphony, and that was what we did.
Wonderful. So I think we have a fair idea. Dr. Ramamurthy, your last comment, please.
Yeah. You know, just a small comment on the profile of the patient. Just don't go by this golfer, I mean lawyer, 62-year-old, hi-fi guy and all. But the very fact that 62, he has 6/12 innate vision, and this is his first visit to an ophthalmologist tells me that he's a fairly easygoing person. So he's going to, he's been living with it, and it's not that just because he's a hi-fi society, his demands are going to be very high. I would not hesitate putting in a trifocal toric also in this case, because that's going to give him very good quality of vision, very good quantity of vision also for different distances. I won't like to repeat the features that have already been mentioned as far as intraoperative management is concerned.
So Gaurav, yes. One is that sometimes a lot of pseudo exfoliation, the whole bag IOL complex subluxates in the future. So that is something that you should be aware of. The second thing which we forgot is that we could use phenocane or Ometria if that is available. And the third thing is, if there is a reasonable doubt that there is a PCR, then I tie a suture on one of the eyelets of the endocapsular ring before I thread it in. Because otherwise, so that means if there is a PCR and the endocapsular ring is actually enlarging the PCR, then you need to take out the endocapsular ring.
Very good tips, sir, because I have been doing that for some time. It's called the suture secured CTR, that's how I like to call it. But it's very, very useful, and it can save you the day one of these days. So Saurabh, can you quickly go on to your next one, and then we'll move on.
So it's a 54-year-old female executive, underwent the right eye phacoemulsification to the aspheric foldable IOL through a 2.2 millimeter temporal incision, followed by the left eye after 4 weeks. Post-op, her uncorrected visual acuity is 6.6 and 6 with the addition of +2 in both the eyes. But she still complains of heaviness, inability to open both her eyes, pinching of the lids temporarily, grittiness, and occasional glare to light. So how are we going to deal with such a patient? And this photograph is something this is what she is trying to draw out, telling that yes, she feels that her eyes do not open from the temporal side. So that's what she said, and that's the photograph which she's blackened out slightly on the temporal side.
So does she tell this for both her eyes or for one of the eyes which was operated?
For both the eyes. So that's what she's drawn here, where the slide is showing, and that's what her picture shows, that she says that she feels that the eyes have become smaller here.
Dr. Naushir, would you like to comment? Okay, we'll go with Dr. Naushir first and then Dr. Maipal, sir.
Are these two dysphotopsias? Is it a dysphotopsia? Yes. Two things. One thing is, these look like a dysphotopsia, both sides. And the other thing is that he should be, that person should be investigated for dry eye. That could be.
Can you answer, sir? Is it dysphotopsia that you're thinking, or it's more like a pinching thing in the corner of the lids?
So you're asking me, Gaurav?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so the patient had a mild meibomitis, and that's what we saw, and that's what we were thinking to start off with. But then she landed up with the photograph which has been shown down there, where there she is showing that sort of a blackish sort of a thing. So she was not very specific with her complaints.
So I think there are two complaints here. One is the dysphotopsia, and other is the, you know, typical thing in the lateral canthus, which is there in both eyes, that feeling. Dr. Maipal, you wanted to tell us something.
This is a typical picture of a negative dysphotopsia. So what is done, Dr. Roop's son has introduced, which is a patented technology and which is commercially available, is that you are just putting the outer rim of the ICL equivalent, of contact air. So what they do is that they have just the ring outside without the optic of that. Okay. So that equivalent of ICL, what's the name of contact air ICL?
IPCL.
IPCL.
Yeah. So what they do is, it's just the periphery of that, and you put it as a sulcoflex lens. And the dysphotopsia disappears in all the cases of negative dysphotopsia. So try this out. It is commercially available, and that is something that can give instant relief to the patient. Just go ahead, buy that. It's pretty cheap. Put it in the sulcus, and the interface that you have, or the reason for the dysphotopsia, that just totally disappears. So that is something that we need to make our people aware of, and try it. And we should have people reporting whether they feel that this is working or not.
I think that's a very good tip, sir. But second part was the grittiness and everything that Saurabh said. Dr. Himanshu, would you like to chip in with that? Like, what do you think? Is there an additional thing
with respect to the negative dysphotopsia? Most often than not, it disappears. If your patients, and time is the most important criteria. Within a few months, it disappears. Else, as Maipal said, that we can put the lens. With respect to the dryness, this is the most common complaint, the biggest irritant that we have for every patient post-cataract, more than LASIK patient, is dryness. surgery acha nahi hua hai.
So what would you, how would you address it? Can you tell us quickly?
It basically reducing the steroids and the antibiotics pretty fast. First 10 days of antibiotics, steroids to be tapered down in 3 weeks, and lubricant eye drops. And of course, try and treat and diagnose and tell them that you have dry eyes pre-surgery. That's
sort of, how did you manage it? Yeah.
Right. So we did work up the patient for the for dry eyes. We did this SBM as well as the lippy view, and then we did go ahead and did a lippy flow for the patient. And the patient, and then we reassured the patient to wait. And it's actually been about 3 months. Her symptoms have come down, but they're not fully, like, she still has to come because of lockdown. She hasn't landed back to the hospital. But when I did put up this case, I was also when Dr. Prakhar's thing, what we were talking about, Dr. Mahipal was talking about, I was trying to get that into the discussion as well, that when can we use that? And if anybody in the panel has used the mascot's lens, where that we're talking about the bag in the like it's IOL in the bag. That means that it's got a sulcus around the lens where you're putting the rexus, and you're getting the rexus in the bag in the IOL haptic.
The point is actually, Saurabh, that is for the second eye surgery. The point is that this case has already happened, and then you have to do with the bag. You can push it back, etc. But just try this particular thing. It's just a piggyback thing that you're putting.
I've done it in a separate case. I've already tried it out, and I did find that it is a very useful tool.
Yeah, it is useful. So basically, there are several theories. So all that I'm trying to say, that this was released only in this AIOS conference in February.
So it is called as the ND ring. And it is made up of silicon. And it doesn't need, it will fit in, it doesn't need the sulcus measurement, and basically it needs only white to white measurement.
It is, I don't think it is made of silicon. I think it is the same material as the IPCL.
So it is silicon. I'm reading from the paper that is.
So it is basically
that I reviewed actually. So that is.
Okay.
Wonderful. So I think that's a lot of great information. Susan, you want to say something?
So I was just saying that we've also added it in our consent forms, about, because we've been seeing that a lot of patients are coming with this negative dysphotopsia, and this is the main concern. So my message across is that lately we've changed when the last prints for our lenses were going on, and with the newer lenses, we're trying to avoid getting the square edges back into the lenses to avoid PCOs. The number of patients coming back with the negative dysphotopsias have gone up, and we've now put it in our consent forms as well, that you can have this, and it might take some time after this procedure to get rid of it.
Okay, Saurabh, before I go on to the next one, can you quickly tell us that, do you see a lot of advantage? You've been doing a lot of lipid flow. Have you seen a lot of benefit for these kind of post-op patients other than the dysphotopsia with the other complaints that you said? Do you think that is useful, or it's not been a great addition for you?
I've got it done for my eyes itself. So I did find, and that's when I chose it over the other technologies, when I had to choose which one to take. So it was done on my eyes, and I also got the IPL done for my eyes, and there was a lot of difference. One, I got the IPL, the other one, I got the lippy flow, and that's how it took a call on the lippy flow. So And I have some of my patients who don't come back, and like they, but there are others who do come back, and that's a problem. So
some will do well and some won't. I think we'll stop it here because we'll go on to the next one, and we are running a little behind schedule. Dr. Suresh, Saurabh, can you de-link your presentation? I'll request Dr. Saurabh to come to Dr. Suresh, and I'll request Dr. Jethwa to keep his presentation ready. Dr. Suresh.
Yes, sir.
And I'll request the audience to keep sending in their responses to us. We are following your responses on what you would choose in these cases, and we'll come back to those answers later on. While Dr. Suresh is linking up, somebody had asked a question, and I'll put it to the panel, that if there is a high myope surgeon himself, would they recommend a trifocal lens for them or not for an eye surgeon? Can anybody, one person, take responsibility to answer this?
I think you can. I mean, we have done that, and it works reasonably well. Of course, the usual counseling that we do for all patients needs to be done.
Sure. So it's not a no-no, and you have been, most of the surgeons have done it, and I think it works well. So Dr. Suresh, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, and thank you so much, Dr. Gaurav, for giving me opportunity to participate in this symposium. The case which I'm going to present today is 57-year-old doctor, radiologist, and he was working in Gujarat.
he was keen for cataract surgery and lens implantation with minimal or no dependence on glasses. And there was a history of bilateral 16-cut radial keratotomy 25 years back. And his best corrected visual acuity was 624 in the right eye and 6x9 in the left eye. And anterior segment examination revealed a 16-cut RK scar, which was done 25 years back, and posterior segment was normal. And he was very keen that he needs some technology or some technique which can help him to minimize dependence on glasses. And out of the monofocal, multifocal, trifocal, or toric lenses available, I want the opinion of our panelists that which lens you will like to go ahead with this particular case, a radiologist and with minimal dependence on glasses, with history of RK done 25 years back.
I'm going to ask Dr. Tityal to answer this one, please.
Hey, looking into a number of cuts in the cornea, 16 cuts in the cornea will have a lot of distortion in the corneal surface. I think the abrometry should be done in this patient. And I'm pretty sure it will be quite poor in terms of abrometry wise. And best choice of such patient would be a simple monofocal lens. And that will give the best result in these cases.
And we do have, Samresh, who's an expert on the eye trace and he's done amazing work. Samresh, do you like to see these patients on the eye trace? And somehow, does that help in deciding whether post-RK patients can be taken up? Is Samresh there? Or if Dr. Namrata would like to comment on this? Samresh, you're there? Yeah.
So this is, I mean, for any patient who's had a post-refractive surgery, a good corneal topography and an aberrometry will give a very good detailed information of what the optical system is. But I think with my limited experience on RK, there is no way an RK can have a regular profile to be, eligible for any sort of advanced technology IOL. So this is a patient where I would, even if the patient has an astigmatism, I would think 9 out of 10 times I would even go ahead and plant a same simple monofocal IOL. Just because it's an RK. So although an aberrometry will add information, it's not going to change the management line, generally speaking, for this sort of
thing. Anybody on our panel is going to
put answer. Focal
lens here? Eye-trace will not change the decision of the type of the intraocular lens that has to be implanted.
And more often than not, these patients are already hyperopic and they have fluctuation in vision. So one,
anybody on our panel who's going to go and put a multifocal lens, let's hear it from them.
Toric, because I've done quite a few with the torics and they do pretty well, though the results are not perfect, bang on, but monofocal torics is what I would go ahead if there's bound to be some amount of astigmatism there, and we do tell the patient that we won't land up with perfect results, but the patients are a lot happier than what they want.
But again, with toric, you have to be extremely careful, Saurabh, sometimes you can burn your fingers as well, but yes, I agree, I've also used torics for some of these RK patients. So yes. Dr. Suresh has a lot of experience,
Saurabh, in this. Can I answer?
I want to just add something here that his refraction was -2.5 diopter with -0.5 diopter cylinder. And without glasses, his refraction was -2.5 in the right eye and in the left eye, it was -1.25. So he was comfortable doing his work. So he was not hyperopic, typical hyperopic, which most of the RK cases are.
So what did you do, Dr. Suresh? Can you tell us and justify what you did?
Actually, I just did IOL power calculation and his K reading was minus, it was not, cylinder was less than 0.5 diopter. And this is the short video clip which I'm going to share with you, very short, 1 minute only. And you can see here, can you watch? Can you see the video or it's not coming?
Not yet. Can you keep playing it? And Dr. Ramamurthy, can you chip in? You were trying to tell us something while the video.
In the sense that I definitely a multifocal is strict no, because the cornea is quite distorted in these cases. But if the topography shows a fairly well-centered cone, and if there is significant cylinder, as Saurabh said, we can go ahead and use a toric IOL. That would, of course, debulk the amount of astigmatism, will not give refractive accuracy.
What about an EDOF kind of lens? Would you hesitate putting an EDOF kind of, IHANS kind of lens?
The cornea in these situations is pretty bad. I mean, IHANS, yes. Why not? I mean, any case which is fit for a monofocal lens, you can use a IHANS with some limited advantage. But definitely any kind of multifocal, trifocal. I'll
so Dr. Suresh, how did you go? Please go
ahead. You know, this case I did approximately 3 years back. At that time, most of the lens like Symphony or the EDOF were not available. So after detailed discussion with the patient, we proceeded for the multifocal lens and 3.25 diopter head. And post-operatively, he did very well. His vision came 6x9 and 6 under it. And he's very happy. We were planned to do his other eye, but he's still managing with his other eye. Both eyes, he's doing very well.
So you were lucky to get a great result. But, you know, I think the take-home message is very clear that in the hands of an ordinary surgeon, let us be very, very careful before thinking of putting a multifocal lens into an eye with RK because they're likely to have lots of aberrations. But yes, you know, in a very, very select case, and if you're very bold, you can get away with it. And Dr. Suresh got a great result. Can you go on to your second presentation, Dr.?
I have a patient who came from somewhere else with a similar sort of a thing with a multifocal lens, vision 6-6, but he's a very unhappy patient.
Yeah, and the second thing I think is calculating the right IOL power is also a pain in these RKs. Whatever you may be doing, you may not get to emetropia. So that again, with not getting emetropia and putting multifocal lens, you will have great distortions.
Yes, absolutely. Calculation of the lens power is very difficult. Yes, and this is my second case, a 12-year-old child. And there is a history of decrease in the vision with photophobia. And he has a best corrected visual acuity by 6x60. And he has developmental cataract in both eyes. And we have done the toric lens implantation in his first eye. And because that time we were not sure that you know whether multifocal toric will how his amblyopia is going to be or how what was the post op vision, so the surgery went very well and toric multifocal lenses was beyond his budget and he gained very good vision and he got again in fact 6x6 vision. So after few weeks his parents were very happy that his vision was perfect. And he, but you know, he was unable to read, without glasses. And since he was a school child, so parents were very keen that how he can get rid of glasses or how he can, regain his vision for near or how to he can minimize the dependence for glasses. So now I want the opinion of panelists that how we can proceed for this case.
Kumar, would you like to comment on this?
How old is he now?
Now he's 14 years old. 1-4.
So basically his reading is only an issue, right?
Yes.
And if he wants a reading, the only thing is even if you can do an add-on multifocal lens, add-on Sulcoflex. Okay. If your primary IOL is perfectly in the bag, then an add-on Sulcoflex is possible, which is refractive in design and which will give reading and does not cause any other issues.
So anybody, Namrata, would you like
to? I wouldn't.
You wouldn't touch it.
Leave him alone. Yeah, I would leave him alone and not do anything because he's surgery was done at the age of 12 years and he's 14 years and he's doing well. So I would ask him to continue wearing his glasses.
Perfect. Dr. Suresh, how did you manage this?
Yes, His refraction was 6x6 for distance and for near like 2.5 diopter at N6 for near. For distance, he's like 6x6 unaided.
No, but Dr. Suresh, the problem is he's still 14 years of age and his refraction is going to change.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Or he's not attained the age of having a stable refraction. So if at all you have to do anything, you should actually plan it once the child is above 18 or 21 or whatever.
21 years of age. Yeah.
Okay, 21. Okay.
Never changing situation.
What is the condition of the other eye?
Other eye is like he has jaundice cataract and he is planning for surgery in the other eye. So in this case, we did the Sulcoflex lens implantation and in a piggyback manner. And so far we had done follow up and his refraction is stable. There is no rise in IOP and he regains N6 vision for the near. So this is the supplementary intraocular lens, which may be helpful in selective cases, like who want to minimize dependence on glasses.
I think it's a great tool, but only thing is that I would have waited till the age of maybe 18, 20 years of refractive stability and then, you know, gone ahead, because they make, but then we could have also maybe, you know, countered the spherical error if one developed. But I think it's very nice that, you know, you've shown that how these eyes can be managed. If somebody has gone through a monofocal before and, you know, is planned for a multifocal in the second eye, you could think about a sulcoflex multifocal in the first eye. Even a toric sulcoflex multifocal can be done. And these are both great cases, Dr. Suresh. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav.
If we go on, we are running a little behind schedule. I'll invite our next speaker, Dr. Girish Jethwa from Anand. He's going to share two very interesting cases with us. And then we have Samrish coming up next, because there are other webinars happening in some time. And yes, for the audience, we have a quick poll of 5 questions right after Dr. Samrish speaks, and we will be declaring the result of what the audience preferences are for these 7 questions. Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Gaurav?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Good evening to all. You know, my first case is phaco plus IOL in post-dark deep lamellar keratoplasty. And patient has a 16-month post-op, sutures were removed, stable topography. There was very high astigmatism. It was more than 15 diopter. The patient vision was minus 11, minus 15, 30 degree, and 18 and 6 by 36. It was a nuclear cataract. So this is its, you know, A scan. You can see very well. The cylindrical component is 17.3. Patient has a high myopia. And, you know, the power is very low. Looking to the, you know, pentacam, you can see that pentacam also shows 17.4 diopter of a high astigmatism. Considering the other parameters like anterior chamber depth and the corneal and pupillary diameter is a little bit high, because patient was taken the pentacam at the time of a mid-diasis. Corneal thickness was very thin, 493 micron only. Even the topography was almost more or less the same thing. It was showing the high astigmatism. Now, what we should do now? It is just discussion for all panelists.
Can I answer?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we would do Dr. a smart toric. A smart toric is manufactured by Iocare. I've used quite a few. They can make these IOLs and results are brilliant.
I don't think so. They'll go up to that much of power.
17 diopters.
No,
minus 15 diopters of
glare is 14. So I'm sure they can manufacture 17.
Yes, 17 is at a level of a IOL, but here the 17 is at a level of cornea.
Cornea.
So there's it's 17 diopters of cylinder, and normally
so
this whenever you do whenever you have following grafts, high cylinders. Then what is generally recommended is that either if it's a small cylinder, do a surface ablation. If it's a larger cylinder, then do a two-stage LASIK. That is first stage, just lift up the graft and then lift up the flap and then put it back. And then some amount of astigmatism gets corrected. Then 4 to 6 weeks later, go ahead and just lift up the flap and then again measure the astigmatism and then correct the residual astigmatism.
Madam, PECI is less than 500. PECI, sorry to interrupt, but PECI is less than 500.
500, then I think there is no option left with it but to...
Yeah.
I think, you know, in this situation, obviously laser is not possible because of the corneal thickness and cylinder is too high. I don't remember the exact name, those Pinot lenses where there's only a central aperture and, you know, these lenses for these extreme irregular corneas, they seem
to... Pinol pupilloplasty.
Pupilloplasty is not indicated in this case because primarily the pupil size was around 3 millimeter.
Oh, there are other lenses available with only a central small aperture. And because of that, it takes care of the cylinder or the irregularity of the cornea, doesn't matter. Something like what you have shown in the picture there with a smaller central opening.
Can I make a comment, Gaurav?
What did you do finally? You can tell us.
Gaurav, just one
can
comment.
Can I tell me?
Yes, Dr. Titya.
Because this is a corneal transplant patient where the cornea is not going to remain same for a long term, and patient may require a repeat surgeries also. And I would, such a high cylinder, I would rather, if cataract is significant, I'll go with a routine cataract surgery, put a monofocal lens, and give a young patient, give a contact lens subsequently, because such a high cylinder, you require a good contact lens correction with this patient. And subsequently, if the graft can be, goes little hazy, you can exchange the graft, take a slightly larger graft than what you had done.
And these surgery in these cases are very simple if you're done on dark. And in fact, with a, such a high cylinder, I might do a re-surgery for these patients, do a better cornea than subsequently think. I think all such high cylinders which have a irregular component, you do require a good contact lens in post-op period. The simple monofocal lens and contact lens subsequently will be the best idea for this patient.
So 17 diopters of cylinder with the contact lens, again, do you think that will be?
Yeah, I think no lenses, you know, intraocular lens can give such a high good correction. And now
can I go ahead?
Nice. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, because there's very, very less time. So
tell us what
so
you did.
What I had done is, you know, toric power is as per dial master. Toric axis is the pentacam or topography. Merit calculator, toric calculator cannot calculate more than 6 diopter of toricity. So customized toric IOL, it is not available in a this much toricity. So what I did is, that I did in a 3 stages. Number one is I did a lens out power calculation, means there is only do the phaco without IOL, keep the patient aphakic, do the refraction, and whatever power of the IOL available toric, you implant it. So and the in stage three, whatever residual power is there, you put the toric ICL. So here you can see the patient was made aphakic. Here is a refraction after the cataract removal. It is minus 8.5 plus 0.14 cylinder, and vision was nearly 6/18 partial or so. You can see here that we calculated the power of a lens through the Virchow's formula, where actually toric power comes minus 10 spherical plus 24 diopter of the cylinder, which is not possible to manufacture. So what we did is, after removal of the cataract, we did the refraction. So refraction shows minus 10.5 spherical plus 20.4 diopter of the cylinder, which is not possible. So here, as per the, you know, this calculation, we found out that maximum spherical minus available is minus 5.5 spherical and 11 cylinder. So this was made customized and it was implanted first in stage two. And the refraction was done again, including the aberrometry. And we found out that our calculation was not so good. It should be less than, 2 diopter or 3 diopter, but it was minus 4 diopter, minus 9 diopter of the cylinder at 30 degree. And then what we did is, as per this calculation, we made a piggyback toric ICL as per the refraction and ICL power calculation. And patient was again the second piggyback ICL was implanted minus 9.5 diopter of a spherical and plus 10 diopter of a cylinder at 120 degree. And after that, the vision was surprisingly good. That patient had a 6/18 partial or 6/18 vision, and with the addition N8 partial, and power acceptance was very low, plus 0.75 diopter and minus 1 diopter of the cylinder. So this was the final result about this thing. Okay. Now these are the stages, 4 stages. And what I wanted to convey again is that we have done the 7 surgeries like this in a case like what Dr. Suresh showed just now, that the multiple cuts on the cornea, irregular and structurally damaged, we can say the astigmatism. In this case, we remove the cataract, we do the refraction, and as per the Richter refraction, I calculate the functional toricity of a IOL and implant in a stage 2. And this gives a very good result, like in a post-RK, post-C3R stable keratoconus or corneal opacities. And in other 6 cases, I had implanted a single IOL. And only in this case, I had implanted 2 IOL. So now this is open for discussion. Yeah.
The only issue is you also need to check the endothelial cells. Because as it is, when you do a DAL, then there would be some amount of endothelial cell loss, and you do 3 stages of intraocular surgery. Then with every subsequent,
we had madam, an endothelial count cell microscope is also there, so it was not an issue. We used the good viscoelastic like viscoat or so, and it was not a much problem because basically cornea was very healthy. Unfortunately, I don't have a photograph of endothelium at present.
Dr. Maipal,
I mean, but, to... I mean, but I think one should be careful about doing 3 intraocular surgeries in a post-DALK patient because endothelium could be an issue.
I'd like to make a comment if possible. One is that what Dr. Ramamurthy mentioned was the acufocus, you know, the IOL, the pinhole IOL, and also the Trinidad's IOL is also there. Extra focus, I think its name is. And Dr. Amar has a series of pinhole pupilloplasties where he's done this for post-DALK high irregular astigmatism. The contact lens that can be used is the mini scleral lens, which can fit even over very high astigmatism lenses. The other thing I would like to say is that for DALK, I've not yet tried it, but for all these other cases of irregular astigmatism, which was mentioned, like high keratoconus, I mean, steep keratoconus, and you know, post C3R irregular astigmatism and all that, you can also do a CARES. That's the corneal allogenic intrastromal ring segments, where you put it as a human corneal tissue within the stroma, and that gives you a lot of regularization. So all this extreme astigmatism comes down to very manageable levels, which then you can manage if you want to get into completely spectacle free with some other modalities, which become easier to apply once you've brought the extreme astigmatism down. And the last thing I'd like to say is, when you do a DALK, the most important thing is that you put also continuous sutures so that you can do postoperative suture astigmatism in the early phase and get the astigmatism to very acceptable levels. And then once you do that, you can do this on the slit lamp. Once you do that, you leave the sutures in for long, really long, and don't take them out early, because then you have good control of astigmatism and you don't get this high amounts of irregular astigmatism. So delay suture removal as much as possible if you've got a good corneal topography after DALK.
So I think a final comment from Dr. Maipal, and then we go on to the next one.
The only thing that I'm trying, whatever has been added is pretty good, but all that I'm trying to say is that the information that has been given that we can't get a customized toric above 11 diopters is wrong. I have implanted myself 18 diopter astigmatism, and you are in Anand and go to Baroda. I don't have any comments in this, but care group can do you a customized toric up to any power up to 18, 20 diopters they can do. So just talk to them and ask them. And I think that will be a better option rather than just stopping at a customization of 11, rather than putting
it. Here, problem was that the power required was 24 diopter of atoricity.
Yes. No. So they have done up to 18 for me. You can ask them, and that was with a
They refused. They had refused, actually. Okay, In fact, both the IOLs were made by them, both the IOLs. After long discussion, they refused for making more than 18.
Okay.
So I think we can quickly go on, sir. Thank you so much for this one. And let's go on to the next one. Samresh is waiting.
So next case was one patient who is a professional photographer. He was working in UK, 42 years old. In a right eye, his vision was subnormal. Left eye was a early cataract. Right eye was a mature cataract. IOP is normal. Diagnosis was a nuclear cataract. Patient wanted a spectacle-free vision for all near, intermediate, and distant vision. He wanted a best color contrast and good hue also. So he wanted to avoid the glasses because he cannot see through the camcorder comfortably with the glasses. And these are the findings we have. Patient has a minimum astigmatism, vertical hardly about a half adapter at 94 degree. And axial length and everything is, topography is more or less normal and regular. Pentacam is also normal. And its aberration, I can't see here, just a minute. Corneal aberration is plus 0.216. So it's also normal. And macular opacity was also normal. And now which IOL I should go for? And which power in this patient?
Dr. Himanshu, would you like to answer this?
He's a professional photographer from UK, and his demand was to have a minimum glass or no glass.
Yeah, this is the classical scenario. They all want everything, every possible thing that they want. And EDOF would be a good option, but now since he's going to be looking through the viewfinder, they complain. In a particular, these are the patients who will complain that they can't see clearly with that particular eye, the dominant eye. So they're the mix and match, the dominant eye putting in a monofocal eye hands kind of a scenario and a multifocality in the other eye.
Saurabh, would you like to chip in here?
I would also like to go in for the same. What Dr. Mehta said, I would definitely want to go ahead with the same.
Anybody on the panel who would differ? Dr. Ramamurthy, Dr. Tityal, anybody would differ? Okay, Samresh, yes.
I would put a monofocal IOL, sir, in this patient because he's a fussy patient and a photographer, and color and contrast and everything will matter at all ranges and all lighting conditions. So this is a patient I would simply put a monofocal IOL and not even counsel them briefly also about multifocality, because something goes wrong, he's going to come back to us because his profession is getting damaged.
I think this is a classical case which would be good for a bilateral eye hands. I don't think near vision is too important for him. And if he has reasonably good intermediate vision and distant vision and quality of vision is good, should be all right. And in case he wants to read occasionally, he just picks up a readers.
Rabu, they need to see the viewfinder. They need to see the viewfinder. They have to have near vision also.
So viewfinder is at infinity. It's aimed at infinity.
No. The near viewfinder. No. The display of the video which is being taken. There is an LCD screen. Yes.
And he wanted to see in LCD screen also for 100%.
They want to see the
setup.
These guys, they immediately after taking a shoot, they see their pictures, and they need that near vision in one eye.
So I think let's hear what Dr. Jethwa did. Come on.
So in this case, first thing was to put an incision where, and my favorite subject is to neutralize the pre-existing astigmatism by putting 2.65 or 2.8 millimeter, and routinely I put 2.8 millimeter of the incision, so that the vertical astigmatism is reduced. Unfortunately, at that time of the patient, it was a case of a 2014. At that time, I had no IL master 700, so posterior corneal curvature was not calculated. And I had implanted a Symphony intraocular lens implantation with phaco emulsification, and IL selected was 21.5 diopter with target of minus 0.43 diopter, and it went uneventful. Now here the patient was very happy, and patient surprisingly had a very good vision, 6x6 parcel and N6 parcel, because it was exactly matching the whatever spherical aberration patient had at the level of a cornea. So it was really making a good decision that we matched the exact spherical aberration of the cornea, and patient had a good intermediate vision, and the other eye Symphony was implanted after 1 month in a live surgery of a Gujarat Optometric Society conference also. Why I have not selected the monofocal is patient had to wear the glasses, so difficult to operate in camcorder. Bifocal, patient has definitely intermediate vision compromised. Trifocal, halos and glare is an issue. Whereas in a Symphony, you get a full range of the vision, good color contrast due to high AB number and minimum halos and glare. And this is the reason why I have selected the Symphony in this case. And patient was very happy once the other eye was operated. And we had done also the contrast study. Patient vision was 6x9 by 15% of the contrast we had checked also. Any comment?
So I think who would like to comment? Dr. Ramamurthy, would you like to comment on this?
No, I think it's a fair choice, in the sense that these anecdotal experiences, of course, all of us have experienced this. Once in a while, a patient is extremely happy. In a similar situation, another person comes up with a complaint. So it's, of course, I think I have no argument with Dr. Jethwa. I might have tried the same thing. But I find that, of course, this point was brought up that near vision is also extremely important. But if quality of vision and distant vision is what is very important, maybe this Ihance is a good choice. As was mentioned earlier, what is going to come up, that is a synergy which has a combination of both this diffractive rings as well as a bit of bifocality features of the EDOF, might be a great choice in these patients.
I would like to comment one more thing is not only the spherical aberration, but also the patient had a very, very a normal size of the pupil. That two things were favoring in a good result. Because the pupil had been a larger, it would not have gotten the same good result in the same patient.
I have a question. What would you consider, or how would the panel consider, just like Samresh said, because the quality of vision is very important, putting in a monofocal IOL and then just giving him progressive glasses?
He didn't want.
That is exactly what I was saying. Ihance is, to my mind, is nothing but a modified monofocal, is a superior monofocal which gives you some amount of intermediate vision. So when you don't want to play around with quality of vision, don't want to get into the jamela, then maybe give this patient a bilateral eye hands, which will take care of most of his activities. But as was pointed out, maybe near vision was also important for this patient.
So I think Kumar has a lot of experience. Last word from Kumar.
No, I agree both ways. It's actually what Dr. Ramamurthy said, that this patient is very happy. But whatever said and done, that symphony will 100% cause two halos and a starburst phenomenon. And being a photographer, he has to be told that this may happen. And all of these issues will not be there in IHANS at all. So as far as the viewfinder is concerned, I think the IHANS will be able to see. The viewfinder is quite visible in the IHANS, even if you target a micromono vision with IHANS with a 0.5. You should be able to see the viewfinder.
At this point, you know, I'm going to stop everybody and take a quick poll. Sir, can you de-link your presentation? I'll take a quick poll for each of the panelists. Just say out, if you had to get your cataract surgery done, what lens would you choose? Let's start with Himanshu. I can see him right on top. Which lens would you choose, Dr. Himanshu?
I would go for a trifocal. I would go for a trifocal.
Trifocal in both eyes. Dr. Tityal, sir.
I'll go for a monofocal lens.
In both eyes? Would you go for monovision or?
No, I'm not happy with the monovision. Maybe a little myopic so that I can go.
Both eyes.
Gaurav, your voice.
Okay, Kumar, you answer.
I would prefer IHANS today.
Gaurav, you are coming. Saurav?
IHANS.
Dr. Jetwa?
Yes, I'll go for IHANS. But unfortunately, I have a astigmatism in both the eyes. So I'm waiting for IHANS toric. So my preference is IHANS.
Susan?
I think.
I will have to say that.
Kumar,
I have not.
What would you choose?
Gaurav, just keep quiet. Your voice is breaking. Your voice is breaking. You're slurring.
Yeah, I would like to say that thankfully I have not reached the stage where I have to do a soul searching answer to this question of which IOL I would need to put in my
Chaudhary, what would you
say? I did do quite a soul searching answer for this for my mother, who just recently underwent cataract surgery, and frankly I put IHANS for her because I thought that's going to with micro mono vision though. And I've seen her, you know, completely happy, perfectly without glasses. Because of the lockdown, I've not been able to get her glasses. And she's perfectly doing everything happily. So I think that's probably my choice as of now. But hopefully when I get there, there'll be more choices available.
Amresh?
Sir, I'm way, way out of the whole situation right now. So I'm really happy. So if I'm not operating, I'll probably go for a trifocality or an extended range at that point in time. But if I'm still active and I'm operating, I'll probably go for a monofocal IOL.
Ram?
I'm in the same age group as Samresh, so still a long way off. So I think this is such a fast evolving industry. A couple of years back, we didn't have many of the choices that we have now. So I will obviously read as to what's the best lens available at that point of time and then decide on that. But today, maybe.
That's a very diplomatic answer. Dr. Mahipal, sir?
I think I'll go in for either a monofocal or an IHANS with some amount of myopia and one eye.
I think I would go in for an IHANS lens with a little bit of myopia in one eye.
Wonderful. I think we'll quickly go on. We are running really behind schedule.
They are not going to put in their patient.
I would like to go with IHANS lens.
Your voice is not.
Admin, can you?
Can I start, sir?
Yes, Samresh, you start, I think.
Right, sir. So, so this is a patient, 60-year-old male, has had a multifocal lens surgery and has come up very unhappy in the clinic. Now he has a cataract in the other eye and he's actually jumped cities to come across all the way to get a cataract surgery done because he's extremely unhappy with the multifocal lens. This is the aberrometry of the eye that underwent the multifocal lens. And you can notice that there's a lot of aberrations coming from inside the eye. which is so, sort of quite easily attributable to the multifocality. But when we dilated the patient and had a patient look at the patient on the slit lamp, this is what we saw. We saw that the lens is asymmetrically fixed. So part of the lens is in the capsular bag, which is the inferior part, and a part of the lens is actually in the sulcus. So it's a tilted sort of multifocal in the eye. And this patient has come for the other eye surgery because of the unhappiness. So my question to the panel is, plan A, whether you want to put a monofocal lens in the other eye or what you're going to do with the other eye. Or option B, would you want to do something to this eye first before you actually plan the other eye surgery?
No question, do something with this eye.
Yeah. So what would be the plan to, what would you want to do in this situation, sir?
First, go ahead and find out whether the capsule is intact or not.
Whether right.
It's partially gone in the bag and out of the bag. And very likely you can just center the lens pretty well. There's a lot of iris dispersion, which I can see, the pigment dispersion on the lens. Clean the lens. There is a lot of irritation of the iris somewhere. I guess put it in the bag again, replace it. It should be doing quite well after that.
So anyone with any other comments on this?
I think from what it looks like a totally fibrous capsule. And I don't think it would be possible to open up this capsule at the back. And the rexis also seems to be somewhat decentered. So the option of, though it's a good idea, and maybe I'll try it first, but most likely it would not be possible to recenter this lens and properly get a proper overlap of the rexis margin onto the lens. So in this case, maybe even if it's the cost of cutting the haptics, go ahead and remove these optics and implant a monofocal lens in this eye and optimize this eye, and then go ahead and maybe put a monofocal lens in the other eye also and prescribe glasses for reading.
I think that's a great suggestion. I'll just move on this case. So sir, this is a situation. We did a UBM, and I mean, this is how the lens looks. It's an absolute asymmetric fixation. And just for the benefit of all the people watching, so asymmetric fixation, the predominant aberration which was causing a problem was a coma aberration because of the tilt of the lens, and because it's an off-center optic, the visual axis was the visual quality was extremely terrible. So we did explain to the patient that we are going to try and see if we can open up the capsular bag and recenter the lens. If not, we'll have to explant it and put a monofocal lens like Dr. Ramamurthy just rightly said. But fortunately for the patient, we were able to center the lens. We just opened up that area of phimosis, opened up the capsular bag using Viscote, and then we injected the same lens inside the capsular bag. And the patient went from being an unhappy patient in this eye to a very, very low cylindrical correction, probably because of the manipulation and two incisions. And fortunately, the patient is happy in this eye now comfortably, and we are planning for the multifocal lens in the other eye now.
Okay. Thanks, Amrish. I think that was a great result. Dr. Mahipal, you want to comment?
No, I am just signing off. I just wanted to say thanks. The only thing I want to say, I saw a lot of questions on the...
We'll be taking up the questions right now. And thank you so much for Mahipal, sir, for joining us. And we'll still go on.
Gaurav, 1 second. I just wanted, there were 3-4 questions. It is called as the negative dysphotopsia ring. And it is not made of silicone. There was somebody, I have checked it. It is made of hydrophilic acrylic material, the same material as the IPCL, and it is commercially available at below 1,000 rupees. So that's about it. And thanks, because there were 4-5 questions. So I just wanted to reply.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, Dr. Mahipal. And we'll go on. Samresh, thanks a lot for sharing that case. Can you go on to our next case?
So again, this is a 33-year-old executive HR guy who's come up. He's had a surgery elsewhere. He had a full diffractive multifocal IOL. And again, the problem with multifocals is a lot of unhappy multifocals turns up. So we get really scared on what to do. So this is just to highlight a case example. The patient has a -1 dioptrical cylinder, residual cylinder in that eye, which has undergone a multifocal IOL elsewhere. Now he's extremely unhappy with the multifocal IOL and has come for a left eye surgery to us. He's terribly wary of the surgery. So at this point in time, what would the panel suggest we do with the other eye?
So, Dr. Tityal, would you like to comment on this, sir?
I think, a patient has a one cylinder that can be managed. If the surgery has been there for a few months, then the cornea would be stable. And we can either plan some sort of a PRK for correcting astigmatism for this patient, if patient is willing. Or we can do some sort of incisional surgery like LRI to decrease the cylinder and see how patient accepts this. Then go for other eye surgery. Most likely, one diopter cylinder we can manage easily with PRK, and that will be option for this patient if the ocular surface is all right.
So I think that's a very good thought. Again, the aberrometry and everything showed a 2 diopter of unresidual cylinder. I'm just going to flip through this. This is no meaning here. But again, it's what is important to understand that it was not the multifocality that was causing the bother, but rather the cylindrical correction. We did evaluate the patient for the left eye. Again, there was a cylindrical correction in the eye, and the patient was absolutely suitable for a multifocal toric in the other eye because he very clearly did not want to get the operated eye touched. But because of the work profile, the age of the patient, and the absolute inability to tolerate glare, he just did not agree for a multifocal lens in this eye. So he went again, we did a femto-assisted surgery and put a toric IOL in this patient and counseled him for a progressive lens. So he has a toric IOL in one eye simply because he burnt his fingers and his experience with the first eye, which was really bad, which was most likely attributable to the poorly managed corneal astigmatism during the surgical time. And that is why he chose to opt out of this eye surgery. So this was just to highlight how, you know, preoperative workup and handling even low astigmatisms is really important, especially when you're planning an advanced technology like a multifocal or, you know, a need of lens in the patient's eye.
That's correct.
So I think that's a great message, Samresh, and thank you for bringing this up, because I think multifocal lenses have very, very little tolerance for any kind of astigmatism. So when planning a multifocal IOL or when, you know, dealing with a dissatisfied multifocal IOL patient, I think it's very, very important to look at the, you know, astigmatism. In my experience, absolutely the same. And, you know, we have something very interesting coming up. We have a debate and we have a panel discussion. We have almost 20, 30 good questions. I'll put them up to the panel. But before I do that, I want to share two screens. So I'm going to share two screens. So one for the audience quiz with 5 questions on panel discussion. And also I'm showing you two, you know, upcoming meetings. I wanted to just share with you what's coming up very soon. We have, just excuse me for a moment. I'll just look up on my screen where I can pull out the group. And if I can share this, I don't think I can. So anyway, it doesn't allow me to share that, but what it does allow me to share is the, you know, the PowerPoint. So there are two meetings coming up, one on the 28th and one on the 26th. So somehow, do we have the screen with us? Yes. Okay.
Yes.
So we have two meetings coming up, one on the 26th. These are both meetings, joint meetings between AIOS and IRSI. These are both international meetings. On 26th, we have the IRIS seminar, where Ike Ahmed and Mikkel Winkert are going to join us amongst a lot of other top faculty from India who will be sharing details of how to do iris repairs and iris sacrilege and you know, prosthetic implants. So Ike Ahmed is one of the top speakers there. And this one is coordinated by Dr. Ashwin Agarwal. And then on the 28th, Dr. Amar Agarwal, again, a joint meeting and an international symposium. It's the international OPL, where we have amazing speakers, Eric Donenfeld and you know, a whole faculty, a list of faculty, you know, who are lining up for the OPL. This is on the 28th evening. So please stay tuned. These will happen around 6 p.m. and the mailers will be coming out within a day or two. And so going on to the audience quiz, we have case number 3, and you can use the polling button here on your panels who are logged in through the J&J portal. Case number 3, we had already done 2 before. There is a 45-year-old male, right eye, trifocal IOL, very happy patient, 6'6", N6, and happy with his intermediate vision. And he has a left eye with significant cataract, a posterior polar cataract in the left eye. On the table, we have a PC rent and the rexus is intact. I think we actually discussed this case during the thing today. So it'll be very easy for you to answer this one. There is no vitreous presentation and we have a small PC break on table. What will you choose? We have 4 choices here. Monofocal 3-piece in the sulcus, a multifocal IOL in the bag with reverse optic capture. Do you want to leave the patient a phakic and do a glued IOL later with a 3-piece multifocal, or we are giving you an easy exam. You don't know what to do. So you have 4 choices and you can go at case number 3. You have 4 choices: monofocal 3-piece in the sulcus, a multifocal IOL in the bag with reverse optic capture, a fakia with glued IOL later, a multifocal glued IOL, or would you want to just leave it aside and refer it to one of the panelists here? Going on to case number 4, we have total of 7. So 3 more to come. 30-year-old male, and we want you to keep polling these things on the polling buttons. 30-year-old male with unilateral presenile cataract. He's an IT professional. And fellow eye is emmetropic, no lenticular changes, no cataract. He's very interested in getting some kind of a near-ability lens after searching the net. So he's a 30-year-old male and with unilateral cataract. Would you like to offer his fellow eye the eye which is to be operated and the only eye which will be operated? Would you give him a trifocal lens, A, B, bifocal lens, multifocal, traditional multifocal, C, and extended depth monofocal, just like the eye hands? Or would you like to just give him and, you know, play safe, give him a standard monofocal lens aiming for emmetropia for distance and tell him that, you know, when he wants to read, he should use reading glasses. So these are four choices for a young 30-year-old male with unilateral cataract: A, trifocal, B, bifocal, C, extended depth, something like the eye hands, monofocal lens, which gives you some ability at intermediate, and he's an IT professional, or the fourth choice for a monofocal lens. Going on to our next question, and we will be announcing results after the panel discussion. Case number 5, 36-year-old female, housemaker, homemaker. She's a very high myope, minus 14, unilateral cataract. Central and peripheral retina is perfectly healthy. The macula is healthy. She has no systemic complaints. So she's just pre-presbyopic and has minus 14. Now we have few choices lined up for you here. Would you like to leave her in the eye which you're going to operate, emmetropic and monofocal, so that this is going to leave her with a huge amount of, you know, anisometropia? There is a choice of putting a monofocal lens in the second, in the eye, which is to be operated, using leaving her with, say, a minus 12, so trying to balance out her and leave her myopic in both eyes. Or would you like to put in a EDOF monofocal right eye to make her plano, and maybe put an ICL in the left eye? She's 36 years old. Would you like to correct the fellow eye for her myopia as well? Or you would like to operate both eyes and give her a trifocal lens? So there are four choices: A, emmetropia, monofocal lens; B, monofocal IOL, trying to balance out the myopia with a minus 12 residual correction; C, correct both eyes, one eye with the EDOF kind of lens, or second eye with ICL to correct her myopia; or D, operate both eyes for cataract and put in a trifocal lens. That's question number 5. We have case number 6, 56. Keep polling and keep sending in your votes. We'll tell you the result, what everybody thought was best. And our panelists might want to comment on this during the panel discussion. We have a case number 6 with a 56-year-old male, IT professional, likes to play tennis. He's got cataract in both eyes, left more than right. BCVA is 6x6 in the right eye, 6/18, not improving in the left eye. Wants to get his left eye operated first. He has juxtafoveal soft drusen in both eyes. And OCT shows that the fovea itself is spared, but very close to the fovea, we have some soft drusen. And he's highly interested in a trifocal lens implant. Would you go ahead and give him his trifocal lens implant in both eyes, or in one eye and the other one in the later stage? Would you like to not give him any kind of multifocality and go play safe, give him a extended depth lens, which is a monofocal lens? Or would you like to give him a extended range
of... So your voice is breaking. You can just start it again.
Gaurav, we have lost you.
Can anybody help him to just get the answer question?
Yeah.
From any of the panelists, can take the question.
I think the case number 7 is... Yeah, go ahead.
Use a monofocal both eyes, that's D. So A, trifocal both eyes, B, eye hands both eyes, C, a synergy type of...
This is not audible clear.
A symphony kind of lens in both eyes, or D, monofocal in both eyes, and convincing that... So you can see on the right side, Richard Klederman. And he's got OAG on treatment, both eyes for 3 years. He's stable on the fields, stable on IOP. He has cataract in both eyes. In the right eye, he has a nasal step. In the left eye, he has edge defects. The central fields are not involved in both eyes right now, but he's very young. He's only 45 and he's a long way to go. His disc shows 0.8 cupping in the right eye, 0.6 cups in the left eye. And he wants to play the piano without his glasses. So a glaucoma patient with early field defects in both eyes, what kind of lens would you offer him? Trifocal lenses in both eyes, a bifocal in both eyes, or a monofocal extended depth of lens, or he would stick with a monofocal lens and give him monovision. So this is the case number 7, glaucoma in both eyes with early field defects, and trifocal, bifocal, monofocal, extended depth lenses, or aspheric. So we've completed all our 7 questions. Please send in your votes. The J&J team on the back end is going to give us the results in about 5 minutes. We go on and go to our panelists. So I think you've all seen these questions. Would you like to start by telling us, Dr. Kumar, would you like to comment in this last case that we discussed with the patient with the glaucoma, with early field defects?
Being a piano player, I would still prefer a EDOF, a simple lens like Eyhance. He'll be happy with his keys. He has glaucoma field effect, which is early, which is not going to interfere with the EDOF lens. So I think that would be a preferred choice.
Would anybody on a panel differ? Saurabh, you have a lot of glaucoma practice. Reena helps you a lot with glaucoma patients. What would you do?
So with the current medications we have, and it all depends on the disease process. So a little history would also be very helpful here. If there is a history of progression, and so if we're talking about a 0.8 cup, which is not correlating to the amount of fields what we're talking about, that's again an issue here. Sorry, I just missed out on that bit because was he a myope and that's why he's a 0.8? But there is an asymmetry.
No, he's not a myope.
So there's an asymmetry in the cupping, but his perimetry is okay. So as I said, the history would matter before I take my final decision here. But I would, if the history is inadequate, I would still go ahead and I would give him Eyhance lens because he's a piano player and it's the intermediate vision which he is looking for.
Yes. So anybody would differ? Dr. Nausheer, you want to chip in here?
I would say that an Eyhance lens would be the best because being a pianist, his intermediate distance is most important to him.
So would anybody differ on the panel? Would any of our panelists differ from what everybody else has said? Everybody wants to use the same lens?
Eyhance. But Eyhance is a very new version right now. We haven't had so many studies. So I'm saying minus the Eyhance scenario, would you or not give him monovision and or would you put in a symphony kind of an EDOF lens, which is quite pardonable. You know, it's a very forgiving lens for the surgeon's perspective. Say you didn't have Eyhance a few months back, you did not. We are all talking about Eyhance. What would you do in that scenario?
I have, can I come in?
Yep.
I have implanted more than 300 Eyhance lenses, and I think it's the most forgiving lens, and it's almost as forgiving as a monofocal lens. And with the added advantage of giving you some amount of vision, like N10 to N12, or N8 or N14.
Dr. Thityal, would you like to say anything here?
I might go with the same options of Eyhance. If that is not available, then maybe a simple monofocal lens with little monovision will help in that patient.
Okay. So I think we have a consensus here, and let's quickly talk about our patient who had juxtafoveal drusen. Susan, would you like to chip in where, patient has a healthy OCT for the fovea, but has juxtafoveal drusen, soft drusen, and he's young. He's about 55, 60 years old, tennis player, IT professional. Wants a pseudo-accommodative lens, what would you do?
Yeah, Gaurav, even in that case, since there is a possibility that with progression, he might develop something that finally affects the macula, I probably would prefer multifocals or, trifocals or all of these things. Now, what we have to realize is that ophthalmologists have a very long history with monofocal IULs, We've seen it work well in all these difficult situations, all these situations where we find difficulty with the cornea, with the tear film, with the posterior corneal surface, with the macula or whatever, glaucoma and all these situations. We've been very comfortable implanting the monofocals in all these situations. And now we've suddenly also been given this added advantage with the Eyhance that you also get this certain amount of, it's a monofocal, but you also get the certain amount of intermediate vision. And then if you do a micro mono vision, it gives you quite a bit of advantage. So I think in all these difficult scenarios, this lens does help you and also gives you that added confidence that you've still put in a monofocal IUL and a little bit of, problems down the lane, intraoperatively, a little decentration or even postoperatively, if the patient is developing a secondary pathology, patient is likely to do more better, continue to do better with this lens rather than with a multifocality in his eye.
Thanks, Susan. Dr. Suresh, would you put in a multifocal lens on this patient?
No, I would not put a multifocal lens in this case. I would prefer to put Eyhance lens in this case.
So anybody would differ? Dr. Ramamurthy, the final comments for this patient?
Yeah, I by and large agree with what Susan said, though I would not try to do a monovision with Eyhance. Usually what's recommended, what works best in my hands is that to aim for emmetropia in both eyes, intermediate and near distance is good. And for near, you give readers. Because if you aim at monovision, then the distant vision gets compromised. The patients are not so happy. But I would, in this particular case, I won't mind trying out a trifocal intraocular lens also, in the sense that I would like to make sure that the amount of cataract at this point of time is commensurate with the vision loss. If that is not the case, if already the retinal problem is adding to the vision loss, then I would not go for a trifocal. But rather I go ahead and implant this, because it's quite possible that the patient's retinal condition may not progress. And just in case it progresses, still the patient might have need the near vision glasses outside. And this would act like something like a low vision aid. And the other eye being quite pristine, why deny him the opportunity to go ahead with a trifocal? If you get 10, 15 years with good vision in both eyes with for all distances, that's a good price to pay. And if at all, if deteriorates, the retinal condition deteriorates, he might just require some kind of assistance outside.
So I think Himanshu wants to chip in with the final comment. Yes,
we agree with him. We're trying to play safe by saying Eyehance wasn't there. I'm totally for a multifocal if the need be by the patient, if they understand. Not all Drusens are going to progress into a wet kind of an ERMD. The other eye is decent, as he said so rightly, that if the retina problem is not as grave and you don't have any distortion or amsler or something, I would go ahead with a multifocal. Well, God knows when he's going to get it. And the beauty is, we're still not talking about the magnification. You are going to use a telescopic effect of the multifocal with a progressive lens, with a plus lens later on, which can give him the telescopic.
Exactly, like low vision aid.
Yeah, the low vision aid, what he's talking about. So I totally agree with him that you don't have to be always very safe. We could be fine with doing a multifocal. They do pretty well.
So I think we have very good consensus here. I'll quickly go on to the next patient before we get the marks from the poll. And Jaswinder, can you please be ready with the results from the poll that we took for the audience? What about the housewife who was 36 years old, high myope? How would we like to tackle that? Dr. Jetwa, what would you do for this patient?
What are you expecting the number seven questions?
Patient has a good, macula and not much, she wants to do the intermediate work also. So in this case, I would definitely go for Eyehance if the patient has no astigmatism. So that will be my first choice. And a bilateral implantation in a short duration, keeping the, little difference of the target vision. So that gives a best vision in such patients.
So she has no cataract in the other eye. Would you convince her to get operated? She's only 36. She will be losing her accommodation as well.
No, in the other eye, I will not allow. I will not go for a surgery for the other eye.
But then for this eye, would you try to do a plano or you'll give her?
No, I'll try to. Usually, I keep minus 0.4 or minus 0.5 target in Eyehance lenses. And
but this patient is minus 14 in the other eye, sir. She will have a lot of anisometropia. One eye is minus 14. And the other eye,
we can very well convince her for the clear lens extraction, because the patient has definitely minus 14. She is not going to wear contact lens or other thing. So ask, its counseling is very important in such patients. They usually convince for the clear lens extraction also in such cases.
We have three people wanting to comment: Himanshu, and then Susan, and then Saurabh, and then Dr. Ramamurthy. Okay, Himanshu first.
I would say a myope always loves to read without glasses. Always. So I would keep a minus 2 around that in that particular eye if I'm going with the monofocal. And putting a trifocal is not a problem. She's going to develop a cataract in the other eye pretty soon. Putting an ICL in the other eye, great option. If the patient doesn't want a contact lens by itself. But I can be assured if a cataract in one eye, he's going to get the cataract in the other eye soon. So a minus 2 if it's a monofocal, for sure, because they love reading without glasses. If I make them plano, they're going to curse me. That's all.
And can we go ahead with Saurabh wanting to chip in?
Yeah, so I was also saying that I'll try to keep her slightly myopic, but not minus 2, maybe a minus 1. And I want to persuade her to go ahead with the ICL in the other eye.
ICL in the other eye, Susan?
Yeah, so basically, now she said she's got cataract in this eye. You definitely have to deal with the cataract in that eye. And you could make a plano or give her a little bit of myopia, a small amount of myopia in that eye. But also being a high myope, maybe you can also consider another option which Gaurav you have not mentioned, that is try to avoid an intraocular surgery and handle that power either on the cornea or just ask her to wear a contact lens. So that's another option if you want to avoid an intraocular surgery for some time.
Dr. Ramamurthy, good option, Susan. Yes.
We have to differentiate between a low myope and a high myope. A high myope usually doesn't have great near vision. So what we are talking about, excellent near vision all along, doesn't really apply to them. I would not hesitate to go ahead and put a multifocal or a trifocal lens in this one eye of the patient and aim at emetropia. And the second, I would strongly disagree that we do a clear lens extraction for eye myopia. You never know how many years it's going to take. So if the AC depth is adequate, go ahead and put a phakic IOL. She's going to be bilaterally nearly matching, and then she's going to do quite well.
So I think great answers. And, you know, I have a very interesting question come up from the audience. They have said that, can you explain, we keep talking about micro-monovision. Samresh, can you explain micro-monovision and in the context of monofocal lenses or the EDOF monofocal lenses, how do we do that?
So I'm not a big fan of micro-monovision, so I may not be the right choice, but I'll tell you what I, for me, if I'm putting an intermediate...
You monovision from micro-monovision?
Yeah, so I think what micro-monovision stands for is to treat one eye and make it emmetropic, and the other eye leave it a little myopic between 0.75 to 1 diopter, so that you get that certain range of distance to intermediate to slightly near vision when you're using an intermediate dominant lens like a Symphony or a 2.5 Risto. But in my hands, I don't think that has worked very favorably. What I would do is basically aim for emmetropia for both the eyes with the distance correction. Or maybe a slight myopia, maybe a one or a little more than one, because that micro monovision does not really, in my hands, give much range of vision.
Also, another question for you, Samresh, that have you had the chance to do an eye trace, or maybe Saurabh Chaudhary, on eye trace on an eye hands versus a monofocal? What is the difference that you would see on the internal aberrations?
So in my experience, a multifocal lens, no matter what sort of multifocal lens on an eye trace platform, will not show you a significant aberration change. And I don't really cannot comment on how it is. Even with the other aberrometers like the Hartmann-Shaik, a multifocal will not show you a chatter, which is what we expect more often than not, because the zone that it's checking you in is in the clear lens zone. So if you're looking at a full ad multifocal lens, you will get a myopia. They will show you a refraction of a myopia. If you're looking at a distance dominant lens, you'll show you emmetropia, but it will not show you much of an aberration change.
I think, Gaurav, may I?
Yes, please. Yes.
I most often agree with what Samresh says, but in this case, I would slightly differ on what he said about micro monovision. I think it's a very extremely important tool that we have in our lens, and we are constantly using with low-ad multifocals, and especially with an EDOF lens like a Symphony. Actually, the study multicentric trial that we did was for bilateral implantation. And first eye, you aim for emmetropia, and the second eye, depending upon the outcome, you slightly titrate the power. Let me explain with an example. Supposing you get 21.1 in both eyes, the power of the lens. You put 21 in the first eye. If the patient says that he's not able to read quite comfortably, aim at 22. That is, you are slightly increasing, aiming at about minus 0.75. Bilaterally implanted, these patients do very well. So we are constantly doing it, implanting in the first eye, whether it's a trifocal, multifocal, or a EDOF lens. And looking at the comfort level of the patient in the first eye, and depending upon that, titrating the power that we implant in the second eye, so that bilaterally implanted, these patients do well. I think micro-monovision is an extremely important tool that we have in our hands. That's the reason I won't like to do bilateral simultaneous surgery, but leave at least 2 weeks gap between the two eyes so that I can get the best out of results with the both eye implantation.
Dr. Himanshu, yes.
Yeah, micro-monovision does not apply to a monofocal lens. It's a monovision. When we talk of micro-monovision, it automatically means a multifocal lens. Like Ramu, I'm a great proponent of that micro-monovision. It works beautifully for distance and near, no question about it. And it's the best way that I would go ahead. Monovision with all my monofocals, patients, if they want multifocality and they don't want to crib, I'm total devotee of a monovision with a monofocal.
So I think we have the poll results. Thank you so much. I'm sharing the screen from the poll results. We've just got it in from the J&J team, and let's see what it shows up. So here we are, and let me just try to set this up so that I can see it in a better way. Okay, so we have case number one, which was basically a diabetic 65 years old male lawyer and with astigmatism. So our voting was just a regular multifocal lens in only 2% of the audience. Multifocal toric, in spite of being diabetic and being a lawyer, 22% of the audience. And EDOF monofocal lens by the 17%. And toric IOL as expected, I think 57%. So I think the consensus is good. Almost everybody wants to play it safe. No multifocal. They want to go with a toric lens. But yes, it can be thought about doing a multifocal toric as well, as our understanding gets better and better. No maculopathy there. Case number two was a 55 years old actress with a mild hyperope and with wanting some kind of accommodative lenses. So again, our answers are for a multifocal lens, 35%. For some reason, I think the choices here went wrong. So I think that's why everybody was commenting that why we have the same choices as the first case. Essentially, for the correct choices would have been here was a bifocal, a trifocal, and the third one was to be EDOF, and the last one was supposed to be a plano, a monovision. So I think what people have voted for, 35% people voted for a bifocal lens, multifocal, bifocal. About 26% have voted for a trifocal lens, or maybe the other way around. And then another 27% for an eye-hands kind of a lens. And about 10% of people have voted for monovision. So I think it's a fair distribution, and most surgeons are wanting some kind of near ability. And so this would be for case number two. Case number three is right here. So case number three is, let me go back. 45 years old male, trifocal in the right eye, second eye posterior polar cataract, and rexus intact, PC rent. Monofocal three-piece in the sulcus. Half the audience wants to do that. Another, in spite of the fact that the first eye has a trifocal lens, people want to play it safe. In the second eye, they're okay to put a monofocal lens. Patient may be very unhappy. Another choice is to put a multifocal in the bag. So almost 41% people wanting to do that with a reverse optic capture. Third choice, leave the patient aphakic and come back later to do a glued IOL. And yes, our people are very, very confident. None of them are saying that we don't know what to do. So I think we have a very confident lot of surgeons in the audience, and they are very confident of what they want to do. Half of them want to put in a monofocal and get okay with it. Half of them want to put in a multifocal in the bag and do a reverse optic capture. Going on to case number five, 36 years old female homemaker with high myopia. So 15% people want to leave her emetropia in the eye, which is operated. Almost 11% are wanting to make her myopic in both eyes. And 45% wanting to do right eye, the cataract eye with the EDOF monofocal, and the fellow eye with an ICL. And yes, 27%. So overwhelming majority wants to do both eyes. Half of them wanting to do one eye cataract and one eye ICL. And about 25% wanting to do trifocal in both eyes. So the consensus is pretty clear. We want to make sure that both her eyes are working well together. And case number six, this should be. This is a 30-year-old patient with a unilateral cataract and a presenile cataract only in one eye and wants surgery. 36% people are okay to put a trifocal lens in this only eye, and only 2% want to put. So this shows very clearly that we are moving totally away from bifocal lenses to trifocal lenses. So there is definitely no doubt that we are doing that. And we have extended depth, almost 60% people wanting to put an extended depth. I think because the patient is an IT professional and wants intermediate vision, they are okay to put excellent distance vision and some intermediate ability. So that's an overwhelming number of people who are ready to implant one of the, pseudo accommodative lenses. Only 2% wanting to put a monofocal. That's quite an eye opener for me. I'm sure in the panel also, everybody is happy to see this, that almost say 90% people choosing either a trifocal or a extended depth monofocal lens. That's quite dramatic. So going to our next case, 56 year old IT professional tennis player with ARMD, 15% people are okay to put trifocal lens. About 56% are wanting to put in a EDOF monofocal lens, and 16% wanting to put the ERV kind of lens like the Symphony, and 11% want to put in the monofocal lens. So again, people willing to take the risk or wanting to go for some kind of a lens, but overwhelmingly for a monofocal extended depth where the risk of halos and glare may not be there. Coming to our last case, the male piano, the Richard Clayderman kind of patient with glaucoma, stable glaucoma in both eyes with on treatment with stable fields, but with field defects. So 13% people wanting to put in a trifocal lens, about only 1% for a bifocal. That again tells us that people are going away from bifocals into trifocals, and 63% wanting to put in a monofocal extended depth like the Eyhance kind of a lens. So I think we've seen an overwhelming in these, wherever there is a risky situation, people have opted for a you know, IHANS or extended depth kind of a lens, which does not have multifocality, and 21% wanting to go for a monofocal lens. So I think it's quite an eye opener, and anybody from the panel wants to comment. Dr. Tithiyal, let's hear what you would think about this poll.
It is a not very surprising, and we all are doing a similar practice. And this shows that concept of understanding newer generation IOLs to us and explaining to patients and getting good results is, you know, gone through the entire our paternity. So I think that's a good survey we have done, and we know that people are doing a good job.
So would you be thinking that the market is totally moving away from the bifocal, multifocal lenses and going totally into trifocal? Do you think the glare and halos, there was another question from the audience that is glare and halos much less with trifocals as compared
to bifocals? That is true. If you are going for a newer generation trifocal, even a Symphony IOLs, whatever studies I have done looking for a binocularity, stereo acuity, for a distance, near, intermediate, these lenses are far better than the previous bifocal lenses. And the number of cases now increase significantly in last 2-3 years because of a new generation lenses. If I see my earlier, just 3 or 4 years back, my bifocal lenses or a multifocal at that time used to be around 4-7%. Today, my practice touches up to 15-20% of patients of mine go for these lenses. So that's a significant change from our routine standard bifocal lenses.
Wonderful. Closing remarks from Kumar. We'll come to everybody. Dr. Kumar, any closing comments on the poll and the symposium today?
I think it was a superb poll that you did, Gaurav, because it's an understanding of all the different varieties of IOLs that is available today in the market. And it's very impressive that they are all thinking similarly. So that was a good conclusion that, yes, today we have the new lenses available. I think ultimately the EDOF toric will also come in. So more and more, so technically the Technis ones and the sensors are almost getting out of business, and there won't be any contraindication for the EDOFs or the toric EDOFs, which will very soon come. So I think the whole summary is fantastic. As Dr. Tithiyal said, that is brilliant. I mean, the piano player, they decided the EDOF was very, very good.
Saurabh, would you like to quickly summarize what you think of the poll and the symposium?
The poll was great, and we'll be getting to know. But there has been a... So I was never a good bifocal user. I hardly used to use any of the multifocal lenses, what you used to call them at that time. But it's only after the coming in of the Symphony that my perspective to the whole scenario changed. And with the coming in of the trifocals, what we did as a trial is we in the same patients we implanted, we've got a series of 15 patients with one eye with the Symphony lens and the other eye with the panoptics. So that now we have this patient with where we can ask the patient which eye is what, doesn't know about it, which eye has been implanted with what. So and what the clear perspective out of it is that there is definitely a little bit more halos with the trifocals as compared to the extended depth of focus. But there is no clear winner out of the lot. So you have to look at each scenario, each patient, and then take a call on what would you want to implant. You have to keep on looking at the patient's needs as well as the patient's eye before you take a final call.
Wonderful. Dr. Nausheer, would you like to summarize?
My practice has shifted from the regular monofocal to the EDOF monofocal in lens to a great, great extent. Almost 70% of my patients who are doing implanting the monofocal lenses are now getting EDOF monofocal lenses, and where the bifocal lens or multifocal lens is concerned, it's almost shifted totally to trifocal lenses.
Great, Dr. Ramamurthy, your closing remarks.
Yeah, I think a great symposium. You comprehensively covered every aspect. It's great to know that it's not just the panelists or the speakers, but almost the entire ophthalmic fraternity is seeing in line. They're all understanding the relevance of the premium IOLs. It's no longer premium. It's becoming part of our daily armamentarium. And I think one aspect I'd like to drive home is the fact that whenever you are using these lenses, it's extremely important to take care of the cylindrical component. And very often the disadvantage of the multifocals is if you leave cylinders uncorrected. So toric multifocals, though it appears to be expensive, I think is the need of the day whenever you are having a significant cylinder. At the end of the day, I think all of us are prepared. We are just waiting for the day when we can get back to the theaters and start using these lenses.
Great. Dr. Himanshu, would you like to summarize on that? Thanks, Dr. Ramamurthy. You have to unmute yourself, Dr. Himanshu.
Yeah, no, great meeting. I said you did a wonderful job coordinating everybody, and the polls were fantastic to understand. One of the things that I've seen with everybody wants, all patients want multifocality. All surgeons also are very much for it, except they are worried about the hair, the glare and the halos. So if we stop worrying about 1 in 100 patients, don't be overtly defensive that, you know, you're going to give problems to patients. Most of them benefit quite a lot with a trifocal and a Symphony. Symphony is a fairly forgiving lens. The Eyhance, of course, when you want to be very safe, go ahead with the Eyhance extended monovision lens. But multifocal is not that bad. People are extremely scared putting it, using it, because if you put more money, that means you are answerable to them. Not necessarily. The patient understands. And if we are confident in what we are doing, these are good lenses. We have fantastic answers. And the progress is very nice. That's it.
Wonderful. Nice input. Susan, your closing remarks on the poll and what people are doing today.
Yeah, congratulations, Gaurav, for conducting a very, very excellent, I think, very educative session. I would agree with that trifocals are also a very good option. The problem is that they're more expensive. And, you know, so you have this option of giving good vision at all ranges, either using trifocal for those who can afford it or using the Eyhance to some extent, intermediate vision, at least for those who cannot afford as expensive an IUL. Other thing I'd like to say, Gaurav, is with regard to that one question which somebody had put up about micro mono vision, if I can just take a minute.
Sure.
So basically, monovision refers to something where, you know, the one was aimed at distance and the other was for near. So there was a lot of difference between the two powers that were implanted, and that sometimes made the patient feel uncomfortable with that power difference. Micro monovision was what brought down that difference to about 0.5 to 0.75. That made it more acceptable for the patient. And so intermediate vision and distance vision improved. Now, there's a third term called modified monovision. This is just an academic thing. You know, that is where you combine these multifocals of different ad ranges. So one, you put a low ad and the other, you put a higher ad. And you get some amount of multifocality. But I think today, in today's scenario, the use of the traditional multifocal IULs, which were the bifocal IULs, is really out, since you've got so many better IULs, trifocals and modified, you know, EDOFs and all these things which are available. And I think that is the way to go in the future.
Wonderful. Thank you. Dr. Jethwa, what would you like to
say? Yes, I'd like to comment a few things that since 1983, I was doing the IUL. And at that time, there was no even SKN was in India available. And now, starting from there, we had started 2002 multifocal, 2014, you know, Symphony, and last 2 to 3 years I started trifocal. Now, very simple and straightforward comment is that if I use the Symphony lenses or a Eyhance lenses, my counseling time is very minimum, my follow-up time is very minimum, and there are very, very few patients who question me repeatedly in post-operative follow-up. Whereas in a bifocal, and in some cases, even in trifocal cases, some patients are very happy. Some have a waxy vision. Some have an intolerable glare and halos. And these cases are not there in a Symphony. It's a little less in Symphony, and very, very minimum or nil in Eyhance. So my preference is, I should have a peace of mind. And at this my age, I don't want to spare much time in a counseling and much time in follow-up. So that is a win-win situation for patient and doctor both.
Great. Thank you so much for summarizing nicely. Dr. Suresh, can we hear it from you?
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav, for putting this excellent symposium. And in my practice also, I'm seeing significant convergence from multifocal monofocal lenses. And this trend, agreed upon by the audience poll also, and we are seeing more and more European surgeons also following the same trend. More than 50% surgeons are using trifocal lenses and EDOF monofocal lenses in their practice. Thank you once again for excellent symposium and for wonderful participants.
Thanks for being with us and thanks for your comments. Samaresh, you have the final word from the young guns and the young generation.
This was a beautiful session, sir. This is almost everybody in the panel has been a teacher to me. So today was a learning experience again, but many aspects. In terms of what we learned, I think there is a huge acceptance now of multifocality. You know, I started my career, multifocality was already there. It was nothing new to me when it started. But the acceptance level has increased drastically now. That is what I believe. Of all ranges, and I think we are yet to see the best lens in the market.
It's still not there, and hopefully technology will catch up fast post lockdown. But I think it's also very important to understand that this lockdown has taught us that intermediate vision is very important. Like when I had to cut my own hair today morning to present for the symposium, I realized if I was getting presbyopic, it would be such a mess. So I think it's very important we address vision at all ranges at this point in time. This is already high time that we start giving the vision what the vision deserves.
Wonderful. So thank you so much. And you know, I'm really grateful for all of you to be here all through. We have had a marathon session, 2.5 hours. We've had 3,000 plus logins. We've had, you know, 1,000 odd people on Facebook, another 1,000 on YouTube, and a big poll. We had almost like more than 1,000 questions put up, and the audience has been great. I would be really grateful to Johnson & Johnson for actually doing all the hard work which goes behind organizing this. And also to Dr. Amar and Dr. Maipal and President Dr. Dhami, who have, you know, supported me to put this whole thing together. And I would like to thank each one of you who's taken out time. And, you know, from IRSI, we are aspiring to give you more and more useful. Please send us suggestions. You can mail me to drgl2020@gmail.com. You can mail it to Dr. Amar Agarwal, Dr. Maipal. What would you like to see beyond? So we are looking forward to another symposium on 26th. Which will be led by AIOS and IRSI, Dr. Ashwin, Dr. Namrata, Dr. Aiki Emma, Dr. Mitchell Wickert. We have great speakers. Priya Narayan, Dr. Amar is going to be there. Dr. Maipal, I think, is there. So we have great speakers. And then 28th for the OPL, which is going to be a grand show. We are going to have audience polls and for the best team and everything. People are coming with, you know, we have a lot of surprises for you in the OPL on 28th evening. So please remain lined up. Thank you, all of you. And I think we'll log off now from this transmission, and thank you for being with us. A very good night and have a great day ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Gaurav.